Since Florida State joined the ACC, nobody has given the Seminoles more trouble than Chuck Amato and North Carolina State. The Wolfpack, they've won three of the last five meetings against the Seminoles. They'll try to continue their magic at home tonight.
Okay, Reese, thank you. Nice night here in Raleigh as pupil meets mentor. Bobby Bowden says that Chuck Amato knows what he's thinking, knows exactly what he's telling his team in the locker room, and Amato has translated that into success against his former mentor, 3-3 in their six career meetings. This one very important in the wild, wacky, and wide-open Atlantic Coast Conference. You can see that a key win for NC State over Boston College here has them at 1-0. The Noles down there in a tie with BC for fourth place in their division. Georgia Tech has control of the Coastal, but this changes minute by minute. Get those tie-break procedures ready in the ACC. Kirk Herbstreit alongside. What is the importance of one play to a coaching staff and to a team? Well, in the case of a Hail Mary pass in that end zone right there against BC for this Wolfpack team, it was enormous, Kirk.
Well, the timing obviously was crucial for Chuck Amato. He was kind of on the ropes there, taking a lot of shots from the outside of the program. And it, looking at 15 to 10, 52 seconds, 4th and 2, BC decides to go for it with Brian Toll, and he's met by Pat Lowry at the line of scrimmage. NC State gets the ball back with under a minute, 16 seconds to go. Their young sophomore quarterback making his first career start puts the ball up into the corner, and yes, they make the catch to win the game, and Chuck Amato cannot believe it. And tonight, moving forward, the impact players for this game, Daniel Evans, a sophomore quarterback making his second career start, a lot of pressure on him, needs to get the ball to Andre Brown, one of the better backs in the entire ACC, a very powerful, fast running back. And Tank Tyler on the other side. NC State's defense has to do a good job of slowing down Florida State's running game, which has been a problem for them all year. Keep an eye on the inside of that NC State defense. They've got to do a good job.
They've got to play well on defense. Evans going against a very fast and nasty Noles defense. He's seen the likes of Mario Williams, Manny Lawson in practice, but in his second career start, a whole different deal. On the Florida State side of things, their fans are still waiting and wondering when they're going to see typical Florida State productivity on the offense. It really hasn't happened again this year.
Yeah, last year, of course, they had a lot of injuries to their offensive line, and I think this year it's been a little bit more of a mystery because they've been able to stay relatively healthy, and tonight they want to try to find some rhythm. Drew Weatherford, the sophomore, last year started as a freshman. He is an impact player, obviously. Lorenzo Booker, not only running the football, watch them. They're going to have to throw the ball to him as well, and then Buster Davis, right in the middle of that defense, number 7, will be all over the field, looking to try to confuse young Daniel Evans on the other side of the ball, quarterback for NC State.
The last five have been very close. Wolfpack won in Tallahassee a year ago. Florida State has a borrowed band tonight. We'll explain that. Their fans hope the real old school offense shows up tonight. Kickoff coming up from Raleigh. Let's go back to the studio.
So some of you might take you the entire semester to get this, and quite frankly, others of you, it might take the term of your natural life. So does anybody have any ideas about how we're going to put all this information together? The answer is college football lives here.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by the Home Depot. You can do it, we can help. Pioneer Pure Vision Plasmas. We push the boundaries of high definition. And new Chase Freedom. Finally, you can feel free to choose reward points or choose cash back.
Seminoles of Florida State and the NC State Wolfpack. This is College Football Primetime presented by Applebee's. In this rivalry, there's a lot of history, a lot of familiarity. The latest chapter about to unfold. For 18 years, Chuck Amato worked under and learned from a legend at Florida State before answering the call of his alma mater. The mentor has missed his pupil's presence, while Amato has endured an up and down ride. But a stunning rally by the Wolfpack has the Seminoles looking up in a wide-open ACC race. It is a conference Florida State has owned over the years. Now control is slipping, and Amato has found a way to so far split the series with his mentor. Bowden has earned his legacy as a leader. Amato is still fighting for his. Tonight, they stand in each other's way. Florida State and NC State, now. And there is Bobby Bowden, the all-time win leader in college football, Division I play. He says Amato knows him too well. It's tough to play NC State because Chuck is in his mind. This would be a huge win for Amato as the Wolfpack perhaps salvage their season with a dramatic win against Boston College. Great to welcome back Dr. Jerry Punch to the sidelines. Sidelines he knows very well here in Raleigh. Doc.
Thank you very much, Chris. Well, back in 1983, the NC State men's basketball team earned the nickname the Cardiac Pack when they shocked the nation by winning a national championship based on late-game heroics in the Final Four. Now, this year, it's the Wolfpack football team that's the Cardiac Pack with some explosive final fireworks. Take a look, September 9th, 3 seconds of play, this one-yard dive by Akron tailback Dennis Kennedy pulls off the upset for the Zips 20-17. Then 12 days ago on this field, this 34-yard Hail Mary catch by junior wide receiver John Dunlap with 4.5 seconds on the clock guaranteed the Wolfpack a come-from-behind conference victory over Boston College. And, Chris, the message is simple here. Given the history of close finishes between these two schools, you don't want to go anywhere until this one is completely over.
Jerry, you can say that again. The last five have been single-possession games. Of course, the Wolfpack went to Tallahassee and out-muscled the Noles. Can they do it on their home field here? This is survival time for Bobby Bowden and the Noles in the ACC race after that home field loss to Clemson. Cannot afford another stumble here tonight. And Amato winning that conference opener was so huge. After a disappointing pre-conference, Kirk, he felt like this was a chance to start over against BC, and they made good.
Yeah, it's very important for both these coaches. Obviously, Chuck Amato wants to use the BC game as something to spring his team forward.
Graham Gano to kick off for the Noles, drives out of the end zone. Florida State will start on defense. This might be a good night to kick off because both offenses have struggled a bit, and this may be one of those field possession games where you're happy not to turn the ball over and cost your defense something.
Well, I think it's going to be early in this game with two great defenses. Maybe a little bit of a feeling out process, see which offense is going to be willing to take a few chances. Eventually, somebody's going to have to take a chance to move the ball because both these defenses can move. Great speed on both sides of the ball.
What a challenge tonight for the young quarterback we talked about in the open, Daniel Evans, hometown hero. Kid who grew up around NC State football, a second-generation Wolfpack player, and here he is, by far the biggest star of his night, and they try to make it easy for it by handing off to Andre Brown, the sophomore back who punished the Noles a year ago, but this time the interior part of that Noles defense is ready. Which one of these guys can step up and make a play? Darrell Blackman, they're glad to have him back, the converted running back. They're counting on his presence on the edge to get downfield against that Noles defense.
Well, the quarterback's going to need some help. Darrell Blackman, probably the guy that has the most ability to get downfield. But let's keep an eye on number 7 tonight early. Daniel Evans grew up here locally, huge fan his entire life. Father played here, has so much desire to want to do so well. And it's a lot of pressure. Let's see how he handles that defense.
And they hand off a reverse here. Coming around the corner is Dunlap. Very quickly, that Florida State defense pursues, but a nice gain of about 7 yards will set up a 3rd and 3. And here is that Noles defense that lost so many guys to the NFL. And because of injuries, they're starting 3 true freshmen, 2 in the secondary, Myron Roll and Jamie Robinson, and Everett Brown, a talented defensive end.
I was on the field prior to the game, Chris, had a chance to look at some of these defensive players of Florida State. I cannot tell you how impressive Myron Roll is in person. I've read so much about him, but to see him in person, he is impressive. And also, you'll see number 8 all over the field, Roger Williams. 2 good-looking safeties for the Seminoles.
Dunlap in motion. Evans in shotgun on third and three. Well protected. Flips it over. Complete. But falling down is Barrett, short of the first down marker. Had the football, but stumbled. No gain, and they'll punt.
Yeah, it's a little thing, but for a young quarterback and for other young quarterbacks that are out there, this is why accuracy is so important. It's early in the game, time to throw. If you put it just out in front of him by another foot, he's able to make the catch, continue running up the sideline. It's the difference between a first down and now Durante having to come out to punt.
Durante, who punts, kicks field goals, and kicks off. One of the rare triple threats these days in college football. Will boot it to Chris Davis for the Noles, who stands on his 35. Very high kick. Davis retreats to the 30. Tries to turn the corner, splits a little bit of a seam and gets out across the 40. So by kicking off, forcing the three and out, the Noles will have good field position to start this game. This Florida State offensive line has been scrutinized. They have not been able to develop a running game so far this season.
Well, that has been the big mystery, Chris. And they've had some injuries. I just think it comes down to that. As a group, they need to get more physical. Puts more pressure on Drew Weatherford, who last year was had an opportunity to fling it all over the field because they couldn't run the ball. They decided to throw it in multiple receiver looks. This year, a little bit more of a mixed bag. We'll see how they attack tonight.
Noles motion all over the place on the first play. It's Lorenzo Booker behind Weatherford who gets the call. Tries to bounce it to his right. Chasing him down over there is Willie Young and Garland Heath, the rover. Talked about Chuck Amato heading down into Florida for recruiting. He does it well. And you've got a bunch of starters in the state of Florida, five on defense. That's more starters from that state than the Noles have.
He gets down in there and does a great job of recruiting skill. And you can see in the secondary, three of the four. And this is a defense that can fly. A great secondary, but they've got to get a push in the middle there with Tank Tyler and DeMario Presley.
And second seven, it's Booker. Trying to turn the corner to the near side. Gets a nice block. Does get the corner. And then kind of stutter steps down inside the 40 of NC State before Jackie Claude throwing a nice block for him out there.
Really nothing fancy there. It looked like North Carolina State putting all their attention right into the middle. That's the focus they told us as a defense. It made it very easy. Just a simple pitch to the outside. And when you have an offensive lineman leading the way and Jackie Claude downfield, you have an idea that a pretty talented back, Lorenzo Booker, picks up big yards.
So 19 yards on that carry, two runs, and the Noles are inside the 40.
NC State crowding the line. There's eight, almost nine guys at the line.
Booker again steps to his left and finds positive yardage. Boy, if the Noles, and the ball comes loose, NC State signals that they have it, and they do. So a promising drive for the Noles ends with the turnover. Garland Heath, the rover, able to fall on the Booker fumble.
Heath gets his hand in there to rip the ball out. All defenses today are taught this. I just wonder if his knee was down or if it's close, because to the right of the screen, watch him get his hand in there. Watch the right knee. Is he down? It looks like he's down to me before the ball comes out. I'm sure they'll review this and give the ball back to Florida State.
Here's a better angle.
Watch his right knee. He still has control of the ball. Now, if you're going by his shoulder, when his shoulder went down, then you're right, it's a fumble. But his right knee is down, and then the ball is ripped out. Now we're going to get this is a great example for all you critics of the instant replay system.
Like Chuck Amato.
Chuck Amato and whoever else thinks it's the worst thing in the world for college football. And
well, we who need says to find, that's the worst thing in the world?
Yeah, let's get rid of it.
Hasn't been properly administered all the time.
No, whatever. This is a great example of why to keep instant replay. These guys are going to review it, look at it, put the ball back, make the right call, and give the ball back to Florida State. If we didn't have instant replay, then NC State would have the ball.
Well, the final play against Akron was not reviewed. It was a game-winning touchdown by the Zips on this field. Amato was still sick about it the other day when play ends the game and they don't review it. It appeared that the elbow of the Akron runner may have touched short of the goal line. It wasn't reviewed. That gave the win to Akron. That's the kind of play, had it been overturned in the booth, would have been a win for NC State. Meanwhile, Booker has to sweat and see if his turnover will stand.
Right. He doesn't have a boost.
He's got the helmet off. He
better get it back on.
I'm not sure it's quite as clear-cut as you think it is.
I'm just going by what I'm seeing. The knee's down.
It's always in the eye of the beholder, though. It's
watch his right knee. And watch where the football is. Swabby, give it a stop right when the knee touches. There's the knee.
But how do you know the ball isn't halfway out right there?
It's still in his hands. You'll see it stay in his hands. Once he goes down, then it rips out. And I
think it's...
All right, watch right here.
All right.
Yeah, you'll get a good chance to see the ball.
I see the ball?
Ball is still in his hands. His knee's down. It's in his arms. I don't know where else he could
no,
maybe.
I tend to agree. I just don't think it's as much of a slam dunk.
Okay. They're taking some time.
Remember, it has to be clear, incontrovertible evidence to overturn the call on the field. See?
Right? Is that the term?
Irrefutable, incontrovertible.
TV sport all over it, up there dialing in.
Yeah, a very high-tech system in the ACC. Most of the conferences other than the Big 12 and the Pac-10 use this same system, which is based on a kind of a touch screen. Gives them a good look at everything.
They must be getting a really good look.
Hey, hot shot, if it's so clear cut, how come they haven't overturned this in 2 seconds, huh?
Maybe that's good news for NC State.
Amato's shaking his head. So this is what has people grumbling, though. The fact that the way that it's administered, it takes a long time.
Yeah.
You may think it's clear cut, and if they overturn it, you're right, but why is it taking so long?
No, that's the part of it that I think...
There's only so many angles, right?
Right. Probably took just one until one or two shots. You can probably see it.
Again, a lot of things are not covered in the instant replay rules. You can't look at a lot of things that are considered judgment calls, like pass interference and holding. Many believe that things like pass interference should be reviewable. But it involves judgment. It's stuff like whether the ball hit the ground, whether the runner stepped out of bounds, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So now we're back to the headset.
It's tough on the players early in a game like this when you have the energy, you're excited, you're
now
ready to go.
Now read his face. Do you think it's an overturn? He didn't look too happy.
He didn't look happy. Well, no. He just doesn't look sure. It's not his
Here
call.
We go.
The boy's upstairs.
Spence is over.
The play will be overturned.
Thank you.
The runner's knee was down on the 34-yard line. It will be second down.
You can see Amato's opinion of that verdict. You were right, but it took a long time to get there.
I mean, I guess it's Thursday night. A lot of exposure. Maybe they just want to make sure that it's the right call. But his knee is down there. The ball is still in his hands. Really struggling to see what they might have been focusing.
See, I think if you look at the official's
face. They can zoom in on that, too, remember?
Yeah.
That's probably
if
what
you look
doing.
At the guy's face, you can always tell if the call is going to be overruled or not. I think you can tell before he announces it. So, Noles are in business. It's going to be second down and 6 after the overturn. And again, so far, in the first 3 plays, it's been all Lorenzo Booker.
This is something that Jeff Bound is doing more of. A lot of formations, a lot of motions trying to confuse defenses.
Booker again, right up the gut. He gets it to the 30. It'll set up a 3rd and short. Now, here's what we talked about with the end of the Akron game. And since you're the expert in this field, take a look at the elbow of the runner. Is he down before he breaks the plane? Akron was awarded a game-winning touchdown in the final seconds.
Well, I remember watching this game live and thinking that at the very least, they were going to take a look. I mean, Lines judge is looking in. They didn't even take a peek at this. Which that to me is the biggest mystery.
There's a new rule now. They must review all decisive plays.
Anytime it's close, you're supposed to look at it.
It's Chris Davis in motion. One more time, they hand it to Booker, who stutter steps to his right and gets the first down at the 27-yard line. So Lorenzo Booker, the early workhorse. This is Bowden's fantasy. If his offensive line can push him back and they can run the ball. It hadn't happened very much in the last couple of years.
Chris, right now, NC State.
Now we see the flag.
Steve Dunlop, their defensive coordinator, they told us about pinching everything and attacking the interior of Florida State's offensive line. And I think Florida State's going to start trying to bounce things to the outside.
False start. Offense number 1. 5-yard penalty.
You see the flag come in there. They called a false start on the tight end, Brandon Warren. So it nullifies the first down carry. Sets up 3rd and 6. Will it be Weatherford's first pass of the night? Weatherford rolls out and finds Booker in the flat, and he's got room. A 1st down, jukes down near the 15-yard line. So Lorenzo Booker on the ground, and now as a receiver, the workhorse in this opening drive, DeMario Presley, defensive lineman on the tackle for the 19-yard gain.
I think there's confusion here with NC State's defense. You had a couple of the linebackers getting caught in traffic. Rumpf, the linebacker number 52, locked in one-on-one coverage, man coverage with Lorenzo Booker, but he got a little bit confused with some of the routes. Nice job of disguising some things by the Florida State offense and then sliding out Booker, who's very effective catching the ball.
And first down now, two tight ends for the Noles. You figure, why not? Just power the football. Booker tries to cut it up inside. Heath was there, forcing him to turn it up after a short game.
A lot of times, people look at Lorenzo Booker and they think he just has not had the kind of career that I think many people envisioned when he signed out of California. And I think a lot of that is, now watch him here. I mean, he shows great instincts, reads the blocks, has the vision. I think he's more effective just out in space. You get him out on the perimeter where he can make plays. It's another place where Florida State, when they get down in the red zone, they like to look for their receivers in the fade routes to Cody Fagg at the bottom of the screen, number 81. Very good target for Weatherford.
They just get the snap off. And they decide to hand it off inside, nothing doing. Patrick Lowry, the number one tackler in the ACC, there to stop Booker. He's a guy that plays with fury, his coaches and teammates say. He was one of those guys that made that huge stop on Brian Toll of BC on fourth down to set up the game-winning drive.
Former wrestler, his dad's a wrestling coach. That's all you have to know about Lowry. When you play middle linebacker and you're a former wrestler, that tells you all about his mentality and his approach to the game.
400-pound bench press to go with the good agility. So once again, third down. Noles need a little bit more than 5 yards as Davis goes in motion. Weatherford again rolls to his right. This time he'll turn it up and run, diving down short of the first down. He gets to about the 8-yard line. Booker was well covered that time.
It was a nice job that time by the North Carolina State defense of containing him. This time they kept him in the inside, didn't allow Booker to slide out for a dump off, and they had good coverage downfield. The only option that Weatherford had was to take off and running with.
So the Noles will attempt a field goal here. It's a 25-yarder from Gary Sismacia. We've chewed up about half of this first quarter. Sismacia knocks it through. So the turnover is overturned by replay, and the Noles cash it in for three. NC State won't get the football for the second time when you come back to Raleigh in a 3-0 hole. Noles senior tailback Lorenzo Booker, who's closing in on 2,000 yards in his career. He was the workhorse in that scoring drive for the Noles, accounting for 53 yards. He ran for 34 of them, caught a pass for 19.
Well, he's the playmaker for this offense. I mean, he's, of all the players they have right now, Drew Weatherford will be looking to get him the ball, get it to him early, and as we said, because of his quickness, whether it's running the football or catching the ball, just get in the ball in space.
It's a pretty easy drive for your quarterback when you can run the ball like that and complete a high percentage pass to a running back in the flat. And Eugene watching sail over their head. So the Wolfpack will start from the 20-yard line. Let's go down to Jerry Punch.
Well, Chris, NC State quarterback Daniel Evans' dad, Johnny Evans, was an All-American punter and quarterback for the Wolfpack in the mid-70s. Now, when Johnny returned to Raleigh, he served as a sideline reporter for the Wolfpack Radio Network, where both boys, Daniel and Andrew, literally followed in their father's footsteps. They stood on the sidelines holding microphones, cables, and cords. Now, today, as you saw a moment ago, Johnny serves as the chief color analyst for the Wolfpack Sports Network, and the boys are still on the sidelines, but this time, they're wearing helmets.
How cool is that?
It's a great story.
Oh, man.
Yeah. I mean, Daniel, this is an absolute dream for him to play for the Wolfpack and see the Noles defense swarm in there. And big loss on first down. Andre Flewellen, offensive tackle, with the loss there.
We'll pick up on that on the second. I think Andre Flewellen, you're thinking about this Florida State defense. They lost so many players. Bunkley, Wembley on the defensive line, Ernie Sims. Flewellen has kind of taken the reins. He has tremendous quickness. And that time, North Carolina State pulled a guard, and he just went right behind him and made the play.
It's Tony Baker, Set to the right of Evans now on second long. He has the handoff coming back into the middle. Powerful runner. Hurdling, guys. And into the open field goes Tony Baker. First down yardage across the 35 before Roger Williams is there on the tackle. 22 yards for the other killer bee here. It's Brown and Baker. And Baker's considered the more physical runner, not the speedier guy.
Yeah, it's a great, they complement each other very well. Nice play call here on second down and long after the great play up front by Flewellen. What tremendous quickness for his size. And you throw Baker and Andre Brown, and the tandem are going to try to get after this Florida State defense there. Nice compliment again for this NC State offense.
Mark Barrett in motion. They fake the handoff. Here comes the reverse. They're going to pitch it back to Evans. Fires to a receiver. Flags are down in the secondary. They were looking for Donald Bowens, the freshman. But the immediate flag from the official. Evans got clocked after letting that pass go. A little trickery in the early going from Mark Trestman, the offensive coordinator. Knowles weren't fooled. They may have committed a penalty, but they were there.
They were
Bowens.
Sitting there. Two defenders, Garvin sitting back and Roger Williams.
Okay. So it's a hold on the Knowles and then offsetting dead ball personal fouls, which will negate each other, and they'll be able to take that holding penalty. Might not be the last personal foul tonight between these teams. And so many Florida natives on that NC State roster. The blood pumps a little extra fast when they get together.
Well, we'll see a little bit of that.
During the play, hold on the defense, number one. That will be administered. It'll be a first down. After the personal foul, number 83 on the offense, personal foul. Number 98 on the defense. Offset. First down.
He's the star of the show so far.
Boy, he's killed him tonight. This is a great way for the young quarterback, Daniel Evans, try to get some of the butterflies out of the way. Throw it downfield, take a shot back in the pocket, and they pick up the first down now. Let's see what they can do with this.
Yeah, whacked by Flewellen. Now they're going to try another trick play. Evans running out of time, just tries to heave the ball away. The Knowles are coming hard here. These trick plays are not having the time to develop. Trestman's got some stuff cooked up, but they can't block him.
Mark Trestman, the offensive coordinator, what he's trying to come up with, the reason he's trying some of the trickery, we've seen a reverse, we've seen a flea flicker, we've seen a toss back to the quarterback. The reason is he wants to try to take advantage of the speed and aggressiveness of Florida State early in the game, pinning their ears back, not respecting maybe being a little bit undisciplined early, but Mickey Andrews' bunch right where they have to be. That's what you love about Mickey Andrews' defense in games like this is, yeah, they're playing fast, but they're playing with discipline.
In contrast, Mickey's 64. He's been there 23 years. Again, pressure. The ball is caught way behind the line of scrimmage, and now buried is Barrett. So Evans clobbered as he threw, got the ball away. Barrett alertly came back to catch it, but would have been better just had it hit the ground. It's a big loss.
This is how you handle a young quarterback, is you throw speed at him and confusion, and you bring a lot of pressure. The offensive line, this is a screen. You don't even have time to get out to the flat to set it up because Timmons just came right to the blind side and put the pressure on Daniel Evans. Right now, Daniel Evans' mind is spinning. This game is moving too fast for him.
Third and 20. Over the middle. Again, the throw a little bit behind his receiver. Donald Bowens makes the catch, but it's way short of the first down. At least it sets up NC State in position.
Yeah, it does. But, Chris, the thing that helped Evans to execute the play is he just got back, took a hitch, stepped, and threw it. That's more of a rhythmic drop for him, something that's much easier to execute than some of these misdirections trying to fool the defense. If the defense isn't fooled and you're trying that, you're in a world of hurt. That time he just got back and threw it.
And John Durrani will try to knock that punt down inside the 10-yard line of the Knowles. Chris Davis signaling for the fair catch, and he will make it at the 8 just to prevent really poor field position. There's a flag on the play. 40 yards on the punt. Once again, the active crew in the first quarter here.
Yeah.
And they will probably ask the Wolfpack to kick it again after the false start.
Wow. most definitely pinned back to their own 9-yard line.
So the young quarterback, Daniel Evans.
Not enough men on the line of scrimmage. The 5-yard penalty. Still fourth down.
Young quarterback Evans, Kirk, you said things spinning very quickly for him. He's used to kind of confusion. He's one of the quadruplets. His brother is a receiver on this team. He's got two sisters, Johnny and his wife, getting all four of the kids out of the way in one fell swoop there. And there are the Evans quadruplets. The two sisters are here tonight watching in the stands. The dad broadcasting, and again, his brother on the sidelines.
I saw his father, Johnny, before the game and talking to him about quads. I have identical twins, and I just can't even imagine. I have more respect for him and his wife for that than anything else.
You said after that, they were a little done. A little shell-shocked by the four.
Oh, yeah.
Got a lot of publicity for that. He's a popular figure. Again, a two-year quarterback here. All-American punter. Brief stay in the NFL. And there's Andrew, his brother, who will play on special teams. A backup receiver. Actually, the bigger, stronger of the two twins. Better athlete than Daniel, but just not the quarterback.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of confusion on the field right now with the officials.
That's why we're telling the story of the quadruplets here. We can go on chapter and verse.
Let's play ball here.
Let's take a break here. We'll take a little break, and this AC crew will sort things out. And you know, somebody's going to have the football when we come back to Raleigh. Smith gets the call and had a little hole, but it closed up quickly. Juan Morgan flying in there. He lost his hat on the hit.
Well, DeJuan Morgan is a big hitter for this defense. He fills in as a backup safety. Look, they have eight guys up at the line of scrimmage. The safety's right there, right where he needs to be. Puts his hat down in and makes a big play to push this offense back. And this is what NC State has to do. Morgan realizes it. I think the Pac defense realizes it. As they've got Florida State pinned back, they have to right now be aggressive and try to give their young quarterback good field position.
Morgan, yet another one of those guys from the state of Florida, Riviera Beach. Play action, Weatherford fires down the sidelines, jump ball, and the big guy Carr unable to corral it. He's out of bounds, defended well by A.J. Davis, the most experienced defensive player for the Pack.
One thing you have to love about the Pack defense is they're willing to take chances and put pressure on quarterbacks. That time they bring the outside linebacker Reggie Davis on the blitz, and he is a former tailback who knows how to attack a running back coming up in pass protection. He has got not only speed at the bottom, but power. Tackle tries to get out there. He runs, fullback, and then the tailback tries to help out, and he got in the way of Weatherford enough to make him have to throw that ball before he wanted to.
That won't be the last time they try to go to Carr against one of these short corners. Third and nine. Carr in motion. They run it on third and long. Something they did successfully against Rice, and Smith unable to get to the marker. Run out of bounds by Miguel Scott and Jimmy Sutton. That was the pattern the Noles used last week against a much lesser opponent, breaking tendencies and running on third down. That time didn't work.
Well, it didn't work, but Philip Holloman, a corner, came up there to make a play, and Lorenzo Booker slipped him. And if Greg Carr does a better job of being physical with his block, that would have been a first down.
Not his strength there,
State. No, not at all.
In fact, he's been benched from time to time, Carr, for not being a more physical blocker.
The Wolfpack defense did their job after the punt was pinned to Noles deep. Now they have a chance at great field position.
So Graham Gano, first punt of the night, and Darrell Blackman, they welcome him back. This guy was the leading punt returner in the ACC a couple of years ago. Also an excellent kick returner. Calls for the fair catch. Maybe had some room to return it, but a little uncertain as he returns from the injury. So NC State will have the ball at the 37-yard line. Noles didn't want to take their students out of class and travel them here, so the band tonight is borrowed. But there's a Noles connection. We'll tell you that story when we come back. 3-0 FSU. This game is being broadcast on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Plasma Displays. Let's get out of Jerry Punch.
Guys, I've heard about borrowing helmets and borrowing footballs, but never borrowing a band. But that's what Florida State has done. They have borrowed a band that is behind me. Their marching chiefs didn't want to come because it was taking so many kids out of school on a weeknight. But they borrowed the North Carolina Central marching sound machine. The president of North Carolina Central, the Eagles, is a Florida State grad. And they brought the whole band of 200 strong over here. And they learned the Seminole fight song all week long. They're here playing for the Seminoles, guys.
What's in it for the band? Free meal and a T-shirt. But good. The chancellor of North Carolina Central is a Florida State grad, too. So there's a connection there.
There you go.
She's got it down. They got it down.
It's good stuff.
We don't do many North Carolina Central games on TV, so this is their moment.
That's right.
A little FaceTime. Loss
and
on first down.
To it. Looks good.
Excuse me. Loss on first down. So they hand it off again. That's Andre Brown. And not having the kind of success in the early going that he had a year ago up in Tallahassee when he rumbled for 179 against the Noles as a freshman. And this is not good news as another Florida State player is down. This is a defense that has been just riddled by injuries. That's Derek Nicholson, the backup middle linebacker. Again, Marcus Ball, the freshman, out. Tony Carter, their best corner, he's out. Anthony Hulis, a rover, he's out for this season with the knee. And now Nicholson is down. Talked about Andre Brown a year ago, Kirk. I don't think the nation knew much about this true freshman. He was a top recruit, but then he announced his arrival in this game.
He had a huge game, and it was missed tackles and powerful running. He's got speed, but in this game, I think he showed that he's got the power. At one point, Chuck Amato said, he reminds me of a young Herschel Walker, the way he can run away from people. And this was a game that I think nationally people started to realize how good he could be. And talking about the likes of Miami of Florida, Florida State, everybody recruited this young man. He had 179 yards against the Noles, and he's yet to obviously get on track tonight, but he definitely has that kind of capability.
He's a guy that everybody in the world wanted. He comes out of Greenville, North Carolina. He was about 245 pounds, he told me, in camp. Now, with the rigors of the season, he's down under 225, but still a big physical back and a guy who can get a 10-yard burst very quickly. Brown said he recalls from that game last year a lot of collisions with old number 7, Buster Davis, the linebacker. And they'll have a few tonight as well.
Oh, he will. And in this case, Derek Nicholson was in trying to make a play on second and long, and he is still down. It's like right at the top of the screen.
A non-contact injury. Knee just buckled there. He's a guy back in his home state from Winston-Salem, not far from here. You hate to see that. I mean, any injury, but just a very fluky injury that doesn't appear to be trivial. And more bad news for Mickey Andrews' defense.
Yeah, you hate, as you said, you hate to see that when you just making a cut out in the open field and something gives. Chancey Stuckey this week had a similar situation where he's just making a cut in practice, and looks like he's going to be out now for 3 to 5 weeks.
Clemson's receiver, they have a key game in the ACC against Wake Forest, undefeated Wake Forest this Saturday. Another, third and nine now.
Yeah, just another third and long for Daniel Evans.
And a flag. Noles were going to blitz up the middle. That was Geno Hayes, the linebacker. They did a little twist. Did they induce the error from that Wolfpack offensive line?
Prior to the snap, full start, 5-yard penalty. So third down.
It'll be third and 14. Saturday, the Red River Shootout, Texas and Oklahoma. 8 o'clock Eastern time. It'll be Oregon and Cal. Good shootout in the Pac-10. Nebraska and Iowa State regional coverage. Some of you will see that game on ABC at 8 o'clock Eastern time. Good Saturday. Excellent schedule this weekend. Now a tough situation for Evans on third and 14. He can expect some pressure. So they'll just take the pressure off of him and hand the ball off to Brown, who almost twisted free. They corral him across the 40. So the safe call by Tressman and Amato, and the punting team comes in.
Well, and that's probably going to be their best bet on third and long when Florida State goes to 3 down linemen, is to try to find those gaps and just take a chance rather than putting that young quarterback back there having to make a difficult decision for him. Just run the back, see if you can slip a tackle.
He almost did.
He Dunn sure
came
did.
Close to getting first 10 yardage. Instead, John Duraney in to punt. This one is pretty short, and Davis is going to have a chance at his 28. Not quite able to dance through that first line of coverage, people. So the Noles will be set up at the 33-yard line. Only 31 yards on the punt. And this figures to be one of those field position games. Both defenses have the edge on the opposing offense. About what you expected so far?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be a game where early, I think both offenses don't want to make a key mistake. They're not taking a lot of chances yet. I think whoever has better field position is going to be the team that's willing to take the chances. But Daniel Evans, if he's going to get it done tonight, at some point he's going to have to sit back there and make some throws downfield to give himself a chance for this offense. They've had good field position here early with a lot of these possessions.
What surprised me a little bit is how well the Noles have run the football here tonight in the first quarter. This time it's Anton Smith trying to bulldoze straight ahead. Let's go down to Jerry Punch and check the status of Nicholson. Doc?
Well, Chris, I hate to give these kind of reports. It's not good news for the young man from North Carolina. I just talked to the orthopedic surgeon, Steve Jordan, and they have told this young man, Derek Nicholson, that he has torn the ACL in his right knee, and he is done for the year. Now, Lorenzo Booker, one of the players that come over and hugged him and talked to him, said, you'll be back next year trying to encourage the young man, but you can imagine how emotionally devastating it is. He sits on the bench now talking to the trainer and the orthopedic surgeon, knowing that his year is over.
And that it happened on a non-contact injury right near his hometown of Winston-Salem in a game he'd been looking forward to play. That's a pretty quick diagnosis, huh, Doc? You're out, torn ligament, done for the year. It's sad news, delivered very quickly. End of 15 minutes here. Florida State up on the Wolfpack, 3-0. There's a championship team on Tobacco Road, and it's the Carolina Hurricanes, Stanley Cup champions this past season. They were honored a few seconds ago here between the quarter. That's Mike Commodore. He had a brand new haircut and a gash over his eye. They lost last night to the Sabres, but the highlight of the night was the raising of the Stanley Cup banner, the first for this franchise. Got a chance to check that out, Kirk. Whenever you get a chance to see the Stanley Cup banner raised and the cup in person, it's special.
Oh, yeah.
Enjoyed it.
Sure,
last
that
night.
Was.
I had a good time.
Yeah. That's good for you. Some of us stood up to the commitment, but I'm sure that was a good time right next door.
Yeah, it's the arena they share with the NC State basketball team, the RBC Center. Noles get the football and go right back to the ground with Smith, who is run into. Nice collision. DeJuan Morgan, the backup safety, has been very active in the early going.
Morgan is, right now, it's Steve Dunlop, the defensive coordinator from NC State, is telling Jeff Bowden, we're going to put everybody we have to at the line of scrimmage. We're going to make you throw the football because we're going to put enough numbers up to force you to do that. And this goes back to balance and how important balance is to college football. You can't just be one-dimensional running the ball. And both these teams earlier are trying to just run the football.
That's six DBs on the field now on 3rd and 7. They bring pressure. Noles kind of pick it up well. Weatherford up the middle is hauled down short of the first out of the 40. So they drop six into coverage, but then bring pressure.
I love Willie Young. He reminds me so much of Manny Lawson when Manny Lawson was a young player for the Wolfpack defense. Just good size, very tall. Here's an idea how explosive he is. Weatherford has a head start, pulls away, but the young freshman.
Tigers aren't done yet. Tigers and Yankees in their ALDS. Curtis Granderson, triple knocking in a go-ahead run. Young pitchers Justin Verlander, Joel Zamaya throwing hard. Tigers win it 4-3, tie the series at a game apiece. And Jim Edmonds with the RBI single and then the final out of the game for the Cardinals. They beat the Padres 2-0 and lead the series 2-0. SportsCenter after the game, ESPN News now.
All right, Reese, thank you. NC State early in the second quarter. We'll drop back to pass on first set. Evans takes a shot downfield. Jump ball. It's caught. Jerron James, the young freshman out of Wilmington, North Carolina. They take a page out of the Noles, but 30 yards on the jump ball.
This is a freshman going against a freshman. And Daniel Evans, this time, they decide to take a chance on first and 10. One of the first times tonight that the Pack take a chance. And I'll tell you, James at 6'1", looked like he was about 6'4", going up and over Patrick Robinson. That was a beautiful catch.
Ball at midfield. That's the first real positive play on offense for the Wolfpack. They fire again on first down. Once again, complete. Down inside the 25-yard line. Bryant defending again, but all of a sudden, Jerron James has become a weapon for the Wolfpack.
All of a sudden, Jerron James is the go-to guy for Daniel Evans. Great move off the line. And you know what, Chris? This time, J.R. Bryant never sees the football. He never has a chance to turn back. By the time he does, the ball is past him. That was the first one where he went up to make the catch. And then that time, Daniel Evans leads him perfectly in a nice big gain for the Pack.
Great throw, but it shows why Bryant has been in the doghouse with Mickey Henry here.
Mario Williams, first-round pick in the NFL, watching in.
He fires short, complete to Barrett, and a positive gain. So, little rhythm now for Daniel Evans. And finally, a sign of life in this NC State offense. Myron Roll there on the stop, and another defensive player. That's Geno Hayes, their excellent weak side linebacker who's down. Don't tell me another hurt guy.
I hope he's okay.
Already, Derek Nicholson, as Doc told you, the backup middle linebacker, ligament tear in his knee. They've already told the young man out for the season. And now, Geno Hayes, the sophomore starter, excellent player in this defense, is being looked at.
Well, he's a phenomenal young linebacker, makes so many plays, and you can, looked like he just got a clip from behind there. Offensive lineman getting downfield trying to make a play. Got the back of his leg there.
There you see Nicholson being carted off again.
Geno Hayes at least walking off the field, which is obviously a great sign.
Yeah, Nicholson being taken off, his season over. And this is a positive sign. Looked to be an ankle they were checking out on Hayes, but he's going to walk off. It always seems to be the case. Both defensive coaches, Mickey Andrews and Steve Dunlap of NC State, saying when you have a shortage of linebackers, that's what gets hurt. When you have no corners, the corners are the ones that get injured. It's just that Murphy's Law.
Yep. Florida State has some great linebackers. Mickey Andrews told us this week, Chris, that by the time it's all said and done, if they're able to stay healthy and play, they could be one of the better groups of linebackers that he's had in Tallahassee.
Second and short, low snap, picked up by Evans, fires right side, but the timing on the play was off from the start. Bryant there on the coverage. NC State, positive march here. Now they face a third and three. They have not been very good on third down, only 30%. And this is Daniel Evans, the quarterback who beat BC with the late heroics, getting a chance to start his second game. His dad in the radio booth, his twin brother on the sidelines in uniform, and two twin sisters in the crowd.
He has looked good on this drive. 3 for 4 for 64 yards, looking for another big conversion. See if they can get it here on third.
Dunlap in motion again. The snap is low. Pressure fires out there, looking for the end zone. Caught, touchdown! Donald Bowens, the freshman, has given the Wolfpack the lead. There's a flag down, but it's being signaled against the Noles.
Yeah, they hit Daniel Evans early and late. They beat him up on that throw, which makes this throw that much nicer by Daniel Evans. I think he's starting to settle in and make some decisions. This was a huge drive for him, throwing the ball in different ways down the field, and then the big throw for the touchdown on third down and three.
A busy Walter Davenport to make the call. They rough the passer.
Number 83 on the defense. The penalty on the kickoff.
All right, so Amato's team with the conversion from John Duraney to come takes the lead here in the second quarter.
Yesterday we sat down with the coaches. We said, tell us about Daniel Evans. What's his best attributes? They said, probably his intangibles. Probably his poise. The way he's able to sit in there and and not get rattled. And, you know, early, that drive, they gave him a chance. We're starting to see what they're talking about.
Evans, the holder on the PAT team as well. Completions of 30, 27, 7, and 16 yards for the touchdown to Bowens. We'll hear what his dad up in the radio booth had to say about this touchdown when we come back. Wolfpack have the lead.
Great drive happened for the offense. He goes right to the offensive line, starts talking to them about loving them up a little bit, telling them what a good job they're doing, talking about adjustments. But that drive was boom, 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 right down the field.
Durante boots it out of the end zone. The Noles will start at the 20-yard line. We mentioned Daniel's father, Johnny Evans, former quarterback here and a radio analyst. Here's how he had what he had to say with play-by-play guy Gary Hahn about that touchdown.
What you think of his cool under pressure there, Dad?
Well, he continues to show that poise, Gary, and what he did was he took one right in the chops, but he was able to throw the ball out. He knew he had man coverage, Gary. He knew where he could throw the ball, and if he was going to miss, he was going to miss wide, and he gave Bowens, his receiver, a chance. And I guess the penalty is going to be on the kickoff, Gary, so that's going to be big.
It was, Johnny. Very restrained reaction. He told me before the game he's a lot more nervous than his son in this situation.
Well, can you imagine? I mean, it's one thing to be a player yourself, but then to have a son out there competing as a young quarterback going against the Florida State defense, things not looking good in the first quarter. They didn't execute. They looked like the defense moving around, confusing him, and all of a sudden in one drive, reversal, turns it around, looks like a seasoned veteran with some of those throws, and say another 7 points on the board for the Wolfpack.
Weatherford. He'll take a shot down the middle of the field deep. Overthrown. Good coverage. That was A.J. Davis. Stride for stride with Greg Carr.
This is where it becomes interesting for Florida State. It's one thing to have a 3-0 lead. You got a young quarterback on the other side of the ball for NC State. You can maybe control things. Now, all of a sudden, Bobby Bowden and his squad find themselves down 7-3. Coming into this drive, they'd attempted two passes. Two passes. Now they have. Drew Weatherford has now thrown three passes in this game.
He's got three receivers now on 3rd and 10. And the tight end, the freshman Brandon Warren, offset to the right. And now NC State, having checked out that formation, will take a timeout.
Timeout. North Carolina State, that's their first charge timeout for the half.
Something Steve Dunlap saw, he didn't like. So, a 3rd and 10 when you come back. The momentum subtly behind the hometown Wolfpack, a 7-3 lead.
Go Pack!
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, located on the web at mbusa.com. And Circuit City. For the hottest new technology, think Circuit City. Just what I needed.
State capital of North Carolina, nearby campus here at Carter-Finley. It's NC State with the lead, and Florida State, 3rd and 10 for Weatherford. The loudest the crowd has been tonight. They show pressure as Heath, the safety, dives in there. Weatherford had time initially. Escapes. Checks it downfield. Has Booker wide open. And Lorenzo Booker to NC State territory. Accelerates. Knocked out inside the 10. A flag is down way behind the play. But it may have been a hit on Weatherford. As Miguel Scott whacked him after the pass, it will be against the Wolfpack, and the huge 73-yard gain will stand.
This is why, as a defense, when you play man coverage, you never give up on a play. There's good pressure here, but Weatherford's showing some athletic ability to break away. What you can't see downfield is that Willie Young, as a defensive end, usually used it as a rusher coming after the quarterback. That time was in man-to-man coverage off of the play fake to Booker out of the shotgun, and he just could not stay with him.
Look at the hit here by Miguel Scott, helmet to helmet.
Ooh. Ooh.
That is 15.
Yeah. At least. But, Chris, that time Willie Young, he's a defensive end, 6'5", 230, the guy that you called Beanpole earlier in the game. He couldn't. There's no way he's going to be able to stay with Lorenzo Booker.
No.
And the fact that Weatherford bought more time, man, he was down the sideline. And huge yards for this Seminole offense.
You know, Booker is the only guy that's caught a pass.
Yeah.
Whether it's completed two for 92 yards, and Booker's also run for 34 tonight. He's been the man.
Well, he is the man in this offense.
They've been waiting for him to be the man for 4 years now.
Well, Leon Washington has been there, but I think a lot of it has to do with this offense is still trying to find their rhythm. They're still trying to find out who is a consistent playmaker, who they can count on. And the only guy at this point of the season is Lorenzo Booker.
First and goal at the three. Miguel Scott's like he's not in the NFL. That would have been a big fine for that hit. They give it to Booker. That time, good job spreading things out and waiting for Pat Lowry to dive through a gap and make the tackle. No gain.
Find out with the NC State, this defense, this is tough, Chris. Third and long, they have them to give up that kind of play. Now they got to come up with this goal line stand.
Well, they bowed up against Boston College. They would not have gotten that win if the defense hadn't made plays to stop Brian Toll, the tough runner for the Eagles. They must bow up here to protect the lead in the second quarter.
Knowles love to get the ball to the fullback once they get inside the four-yard line.
That's Joe Surratt. He does get the handle. He's kind of the touchdown scoring specialist. Nowhere to go. Flying in there was Miguel Scott, the man who was guilty of that helmet-to-helmet hit. But a good job by the interior guys, Presley and Tyler, to plug it up.
Well, if you and I know it, I think pretty good chance that Steve Dunlop knows what's coming. It's a trademark of Florida State's offense. You go back to when Mark Richt was there. The one thing Mark Richt used to also include was that fake and then hit the tight end in the back of the end zone.
Well, Surratt, his longest run all year is 6 yards. He's got five touchdowns. He's going to get the ball in this situation.
Yeah.
But you're right. Wolfpack was ready for that. Now it's third and goal. Timeout taken by the Seminoles. NC State student section will try to do its part to make it tough on the Noles offense on third and goal from just outside the two here. Such a big play. Can they force a field goal attempt, keep the lead? Or will the Noles and that huge conversion on third and long take the lead?
One thing to watch, as always, the Noles get down in here, top of the screen. Greg Carr to the slant, try to get the football to him.
Jimmy Sutton on the coverage instead. Weatherford rolls to his right, flips it in the middle, deflected. He was looking for the tight end, Warren, and Patrick Lowry, the linebacker, knocked it away.
The thing that helped Lowry here is he came up actually off of the play action, coming up thinking that they may run from the shotgun. But because Weatherford took so much time rolling out, it gave Lowry and the rest of the linebackers time to get back into coverage. Wide open man in the back of the end zone, but Lowry had time to get back and deflect that ball away.
They'll tuck that away, though, for later, because you're right, Warren was wide open back to the end zone.
A little bit more of a soft touch by Weatherford, and had 6 points.
Just Mishia knocks it through, but that play by Lowry is basically a four-point play in this football game, and the Wolfpack still have the lead, 7-6. Let's go down to Jerry Punch, or up to Jerry Punch, I should say.
You're above us.
Yeah.
Well, I'm up here in the Wolfpack Sports Radio booth with Johnny Evans, a former quarterback and All-American. But tonight you're a dad. And, Johnny, assess the play of Daniel thus far, your young man.
Well, certainly started off slow because of the pressure that Florida State brings. He's never seen anything like the speed that comes off the edges. I think he adjusted a little bit. And, you know, sometimes, Jerry, you need a player to make a play for you. And Jaron James, the true freshman, made those couple of nice catches for him. And I think it got him in a rhythm. He still was getting pressure on the touchdown pass. So I would give him pretty high marks so far in this. Early in this game.
In this next series, if you could stand beside him in the huddle, what would you say to him?
First of all, I wouldn't get out there. I don't want to be out there on the field with him. Those guys are too big, too strong, too fast. He's the guy that really needs to be out there. But what I would give him advice is stay poised, which is what one of his great qualities is, Jerry. He's able to stay stoic in the face of a lot of pressure, and he's going to continue to get pressure every play of this game.
How difficult is it for you to sit up here and call your son's football game knowing how much he's wanted to be on that field where you played 28 years ago?
Yeah, well, it really is special because you know that that's a dream come true for him. It wasn't my dream for him, but it was certainly his dream for himself. And so we're thankful to the Lord to give him that opportunity.
Hey, Johnny, thanks for your time.
Thanks, Jerry.
Guys?
Evans, 4 of 5 on that drive. He's 7 of 9 tonight. Reminds me, Kirk, of Bob Greasy calling the game in which Brian Greasy won a share of the national title in the Rose Bowl, and the emotions that a father felt, and tried to do a job as well.
Yeah, Daniel Evans, I thought his dad summed it up very well in the way this first half has gone for his son.
This is Darrell Blackman with the return, takes a shot and is stopped at the 12-yard line. Well, Evans inherits a pretty tough legacy here at NC State because Philip Rivers, one of the best ever in this conference, and he's now starring for the San Diego Chargers, joins us on the telephone here. Philip, your great success here has made it pretty tough for guys like Jay Davis and Marcus Stone to follow you. You realize that, don't you?
Well, I guess so. You know, I was fortunate to have a great career there at NC State in that conference. But, you know, I think, you know, Daniel's doing a heck of a job. You know, he stepped right in. I got to see, you know, the game last 2 weeks ago at Boston College. And I remember from high school, in fact, you know, he played against some of my dad's teams there in Raleigh. So I knew he had a chance to be a special player, and he came off to a great start.
They hand it off to Andre Brown out of the shotgun, short game.
Philip, congratulations on your start. Now that you have a chance to become the starter for the Chargers, looking great. But if you could go back to your playing days in college, especially early as a freshman, at being a starter, what's Daniel Evans facing right now? He's facing the Seminoles, even though it's in his own stadium. How difficult is it for a young quarterback to deal with this kind of pressure?
It's tough, and I'll tell you, He's already thrown a touchdown against Florida State, which was far better than I did the first year I played those guys. But, you know, I had a tough time against them. But I tell you what, it's key for those coaches to put him in a situation to get some completions, you know, and make it simplified for him, because if you try to get caught up in having him look at the whole coverage, looking at the rush, finding out who's, it'll be tough for him. But if they allow him to simplify his reads and give him a chance to throw some completions, it gives you that confidence, and then he can let his playmakers take over.
Now, Philip, he felt the rush right there. It was Geno Hayes on the sack there, puts him back at the 2 yard line.
Well, Philip is, I think he's still driving to get back from practice. Are you still driving in your car?
Yeah, it's driving me crazy. I got to watch some of it on the way out in between meetings, and, you know, some of the guys give me a hard time. You know, I'm telling them, look out tonight. We're gonna surprise the country. But I'm trying to get home. In standstill traffic, about 2,500 miles away. So.
Well, standing still was Andre Brown right there. A lot of traffic around him as Buster Davis runs him down to the 1 yard line. Again, another cautious call, and now they have to punt from deep in their end zone.
What he can't see is he's on the freeway in San Diego as the Wolfpack, unfortunately, are at their own 1.5 or 2 yard line facing a 4th and 20. And Philip, we appreciate you joining us, and best of luck, man, the rest of this year.
Yeah, thanks for having me on.
He was patient in San Diego, waited his turn, and boy, has he done well since Drew Brees departed. John Duraney now must produce a quality punt, and he does force Chris Davis back to about the 46-yard line, but Davis slips down at the 40, and now flags fly. On that coverage team, a mistake. These guys have been busy. A couple of flags went flying in.
The reason Mickey Andrews is going all over Davis is a nice push in the back.
And that spoils what would have been excellent field position for the Seminoles. Here's a preview of Monday Night Football on ESPN.
Has there been a bigger impact addition in the NFL this year than Steve McNair? He's led two straight last-minute comebacks, helping Ray Lewis and the Ravens open a perfect 4-0. Denver's defense has allowed one touchdown in three games. Jake Plummer and Javon Walker finding chemistry. Baltimore in Denver at 8:30 Eastern on ESPN's Monday Night Football.
Be a big night in Denver as the Ravens come calling. Baltimore Ravens football was what NC State was having to play at times when they weren't getting the pitch and catch combo going, Mark Trestman said. But tonight they've been passing. Now they flip it out one more time. It's Booker in the flat. The penalty pushing the ball back to the midfield for the Noles, but quickly they're back in NC State territory.
Thinking about Monday Night Football makes me think back to these teams last year. How many first-rounders? You're talking about 7 first-round picks alone. Mario Williams and John McCargo leaving early for NC State. Ernie Sims leaving early. Antonio Cromartie after the ACL leaving early. And there's Mario Williams in town, cheering on the Wolfpack. How's he started so far?
He's got a sack. He got his first sack of the year.
Okay.
Texans defense, though, is not exactly wowed people and made analysts think that they made the right call on passing on Reggie Bush. On the reverse here, it's Anton Smith taking the handoff. Stopped short of the first down marker. He'll need 2 more yards. This guy drafted because of sheer physical presence, the measurables the NFL looks for. He was productive, but perhaps not 100% dominant in this conference throughout his career.
No, and I think that's why the first pick overall surprised some people.
I will never forget where I was when I got the phone call the night before the draft and got the news that Bush was going to drop and that Williams was going to be the top pick. Eating dinner at a restaurant. It was surprising. On third and short, it's Rutherford in the shotgun, hands it off to Smith, and he is stopped by Tank Tyler. The senior leader of that defense tossed aside the would-be blocker and made a huge stop.
But Tank Tyler's the leader of this defense with Mario Williams and others moving on to the NFL. He is the leftover, and this time, look at the penetration and the strength in the interior by Tyler. Tank Tyler took the Boston College game over single-handedly in the fourth quarter. That time, when they needed him most, makes the big play, having his presence felt.
Sat out the first quarter for a defense that Amato didn't like in that Southern Mississippi game, a 15-yard penalty. He set the guy out when he got in the game. He played with a fury and had the game of his life against BC.
One of those guys in the middle that they say bench presses 525 pounds. You can tell how strong he is inside.
So a huge stop. Once again, a short yardage play by that Wolfpack defense forces the punt, and it's a bad one. Gano off the side of his foot. NC State will still have poor field position, but a big short yardage stop as the Wolfpack hold on to that one-point lead. Well, it's a huge day in the SEC, and in prime time on ESPN in high definition, the Volunteers favorites between the hedges against that struggling Georgia offense, 7:45 Eastern time. College football lives here. All games on ESPN and ESPN2 also available in high definition.
Can't wait to see Eric Ainge, his group of receivers, Robert Meacham, Jason Swain, to see how they handle the adversity of the crowd and also great defense in Georgia.
It's Evans throwing deep on first down. They fight for the football. Dunlap went up with Jamie Robinson, the freshman corner. They're taking shots down the field all of a sudden.
I think what they're doing is they're taking shots and just putting air underneath it and trying to out-jump. There's some inexperience now on the other side of the football in the secondary of Florida State, and just relying on Dunlop to make a play over top of Jamie Robinson, who's a true freshman. And Robinson got lost a little bit and kind of got turned. They're just becoming more aggressive with their play calling here.
Dunlap, the guy who caught the juggling game winner in the end zone against BC. This time they try to get Tony Baker free. And that Knowles defense, led by Alex Boston and Flewellen, able there to make a big stop. Florida State already with a loss in the ACC. Lost at home to Clemson in a game that wasn't as close as the final score might indicate. And NC State, off that BC win, undefeated in this league. So the Knowles, critical position here in the conference race, cannot drop to 0-2 and expect to get to the ACC championship game and defend that crown. Will they be cautious on third and 13? Evans has to fire across the middle. It was looking for Bowens on the slant that bounced it to him. This is the Atlantic of the ACC, and I want you to become very well versed, Kirk, on your tiebreak procedures here in this league, because we're going to need them.
Well, not in this division, because this team is going to win the Atlantic division, so that takes care of that.
Outright,
Clemson
will
win that outright. Yeah,
all right.
There's not a problem.
They're going to beat Wake, no problem, on Saturday.
I don't know. They better come dressed, ready to play, because Wake Forest has a tendency to lull you to sleep in front of 28,000, and then they out-execute you. So Tommy's got his hands full there Saturday.
Durante to punt. Davis collects it on the NC State side of the field. Check it, is Patrick Robinson in there as they instead use the freshman corner in the punt return team. And he kind of just shoots straight ahead. And now the Knowles will start after the 16-yard return at the 33-yard line.
It's crazy
to
see.
They take out Davis and put in the freshman corner.
It's crazy to see Florida State on punt returns and how much they have struggled. You know, coming into tonight's game, they're 100th in the nation in punt returns and 111th in the nation in kickoff returns. And I don't know if that's the return men so much or the blocking or the timing, but they've had a couple big opportunities here, these last couple punt return opportunities, and let's see if they can try to get some more points on the board.
We'll see if that Wolfpack defense can come up with another big stop. They really have been put in tough position here. Rutherford fires toward the end zone. Caught for a touchdown. Chris Davis wins the jump ball It gets Neal over there. And the Noles strike quickly. That is a vintage Florida State touchdown pass.
Well, that is also a good call by Jeff Bowden on first and 10. Finally breaking a tendency, taking a shot downfield, 33 yards. And how about the adjustment? Nice job by Chris Davis to go up and over the defensive back. I don't think at any point, I'm not sure if Levin Neal even saw the football. And Davis does a great job of finding the ball and going over the top of Neal to secure the ball. Then it's a matter of just does he have the feet down, the right foot.
Well, they'll review that. Certainly was a catch, but was the ball across the plane before that foot landed on the stripe?
The right foot definitely touches the line before he gets into the end zone. Definitely a touch, but his left foot touched inbounds. Why he possessed the ball for the catch. But it's a great call on first and 10. One-on-one coverage. You've got to go out and attack it. Makes the catch. Left foot gets down.
Yeah, certainly a catch. It will be a touchdown or out at the half-yard line. They beat Neal, who's the backup corner, not Davis or Sutton, who was on the most talented receiver for the Noles that time. The backup, Neal, the sophomore, beaten on that play. And that's a welcome touchdown for Chris Davis, who only had 9 catches on the season coming in. Not the kind of productivity for the guy who's considered the most talented of the wideouts. Well,
Chris Davis is the receiver that they need to make plays every single game. And he needs to be given opportunities to make plays. And that time he made a sensational adjustment to go up into the air and make the catch. That's why Chris Davis plays receiver and Levin Neal plays
After
corner.
After further review, the play stands as called on field.
There was no question again it was going to be a catch. Is the ball across the plane before the foot hits the sideline? It's tough. That's the blown up view. And out, boom. I don't know about that. I guess they felt it wasn't enough to overturn the call on the field. So Cismesha able to boot it through. And this time the Noles do cash in on the great field position with a one-play touchdown drive and the catch by Davis. 13-7. The Noles have taken the lead in Raleigh on a touchdown pass from Drew Weatherford. Sometimes football can be pretty simple, Kirk. You know, you take the snap, pitch the ball down there, and it's our guy against your guy. And for years, Florida State's had better guys than the other guys, and they made a lot of those catches.
And again, that's why I think Chris Davis has to become that guy. He's their go-to man. He's the guy that can make the most plays. And you have to take some of the pressure off of Lorenzo Booker in the running game. And that's what I think Florida State teams in the past have always had playmakers out of receiver. And I think that there's been a shortage of that. Of course, they lost Fred Rouse, who was dismissed from school. Kenny O'Neill, also dismissed from school. Those are two of their faster receivers that are not here anymore.
Receivers only had 4 touchdown catches coming into tonight, and Carr had 3 of them. Darrell Blackman on the kickoff return has a seed. Beats the kicker. Knocked out of bounds at the 35, and the special teams troubles continue for Florida State. There is a flag down in the neighborhood of where the kickoff came.
Yeah, it's in a neighborhood where it would be offsides by Florida State.
Yep.
They threw it right at about the 37-yard line where the Noles were kicking off.
Yeah, this return by Blackman will stand. Michael Ray Garvin able to run him out on the far sidelines, but Blackman providing the kind of spark they were hoping they'd get, a 64-yard return. This guy's been out for a couple of weeks with an injury. Welcome back.
Well, this was huge because of the way, not only the score, but after that big 80-yard drive that they went right down the field in 5 plays, the Noles have taken control since then. They needed something to be able to get themselves not only confident, but to get the crowd back into the game. And now with under 3 minutes to go, they've got a real shot here to get some points on the board.
Crowd on its feet all of a sudden as NC State tries to do what the Noles did. Cash in good field position. On first down, it's Brown. This is his best run of the night. The sophomore turns the corner. A flag comes out late. They may have gotten the face mask near the 15-yard line.
I think Garvin coming up to make a tackle. Looked like incidental face mask. He definitely got high as he was trying to come up on Andre Brown.
It will be, we believe, the 5-yard variety, but a 14-yard gain. The first real positive running play tonight for the Pack.
The safeties for Florida State were way back, expecting that Tressman, the offensive coordinator, might attack downfield and try to go for the jugular with the big throw. Garvin gets his hand up, just trying to bring down the big back. As I said, just incidental, but Chris, I think they thought Mark Tressman might try to attack. They're getting everybody back, and a good call by Tressman to run the football.
He's been with 7 different NFL teams. Has kind of that computer geek genius look to him, right? With the glasses, like he's about to invent a piece of software and make $1 billion. Kind of that look. High formation. First down, they pitch it out to Brown. He cannot get around the corner as Myron Roll, the freshman there, wrestled him down. Still a positive play. You don't buy the description of Tressman?
No, he looks like a fine football coach to me, sir.
I'm not trying to knock him. I just think he looks very intelligent.
He looks very intelligent. Brainy. I don't know about geek.
Well, you know, intelligence sometimes equates with geekiness.
Cerebral?
He's cerebral.
I like cerebral. I don't like geek.
He's a nice guy.
Coach, go back to review the tape. That was Chris Fowler.
Positive way. Good stuff. Heck of a game tonight. Pick up 4, 2nd and 6 from the 8. And this is Brown trying to bulldoze his way. He is planted at the 5-yard line. Timmons, that rangy, tough linebacker, met him head on, and all 230 pounds of Brown stopped cold.
Brown gets downfield. Look, I thought he might, the way he can run once he gets to the second level, I thought he might lower the shoulder and maybe go through a linebacker, but Roger Williams, the safety, is there, and then Lawrence Timmons knocks him back. Sets up a big 3rd and 2.
Brown to the left of Evans, who's in the shotgun. Evans fires across the middle of the end zone, incomplete. He was trying to find Anthony Hill. The tight end is the leading receiver on this team. Just over the top of his head, Buster Davis, the backer there on the cover.
Well, you're talking about Anthony Hill, who's 6'6", going against Buster Davis, who's 5'10". You're going to take your chances there every single time.
Now, John Duraney in for the field goal attempt. He's only one of 8 guys in Division I who does all 3 duties. No fake here, even though Evans, the quarterback, is the holder. And that's a 22-yard field goal, so a positive drive for NC State after the kickoff return. Perhaps not what they were looking for, but they pull within 3 in the last 2 minutes of the half.
Well, they pull within 3, and that might be a drive that the Wolfpack will look back at and think that, well, they should have continued to be aggressive. But Daniel Evans, who is our Under Armour player of the game, or at this point, the Under Armour advantage of the game, has made some good decisions when he's had to. And, you know, for a young quarterback playing a Florida State defense, Phillip Rivers knows a lot better than you and I what that's like. He has shown some composure and done enough here to give the Wolfpack hope as they get ready for halftime. Now it's a matter of seeing what happens here with the last minute and 48. He may get another shot.
Evans, obviously, a guy didn't quite have Phillip Rivers' physical skills. He didn't have a huge arm, didn't have, you know, great size. And the best thing about him is intangibles. And he's clearly rolling now with confidence.
When you talk with offensive coaches, they always talk about not only poise and leadership, but it's decision-making and accuracy. Decision-making and accuracy. It's not always about being big or being fast. It's about making good decisions and helping your offense move the ball down the field. And so far tonight, for a young quarterback, he's done a pretty good job.
Evans knew that he had to be effective tonight because Marcus Stone could jump back in there at any moment for NC State, the guy who started the season and was benched in favor of Evans after a couple of ineffective games. Duraney to kick off. And another booming deep kickoff. No return for the Seminoles. They'll start at the 20-yard line. Let's go back to Reese and get a preview of halftime. Reese.
Thank you.
And neither one is geeky, okay? That word apparently very offensive to Herb Streets. I will never use the word geeky again. Empty backfield for Weatherford on first down. It rolls to his right and now flips it short. It's caught by the tight end, Brandon Warren, and they are paying a lot of attention to him tonight.
I know that Chris Davis made the big play on first and 10 downfield. He made a great catch. But if you're Chuck Amato and you're this Steve Dunlop, the defensive coordinator, not only here but the rest of this game, you lock in on the backfield of Lorenzo Booker or Anton Smith. You lock in. I don't care if it's a run or a pass. You make somebody else catch the ball and move the ball downfield besides the backfield. And right now it's a little bit different because they're kind of in a two-minute drill if they're going to try to attack.
It's a slowed motion two-minute drill. They're being very methodical here. Even though they're in shotgun, they will take a shot to the near side. It's incomplete. He bounced it for Chris Davis, but time ticking away, and the Noles about 75 yards from the end zone.
It's almost the not real confident two-minute drill where you're killing a little bit of clock just in case you happen to not pick up a first down, so they, if they get the ball back, don't have a whole lot of time.
But I'm not sure if you have no intention of trying to score, why pitch the ball around? Just hand it off or take a knee.
But I think they're thinking it's one of those indecisive positions here by Florida State's offense, because if they do convert on that second down, then maybe they try to keep going.
Now it's third and seven, and they will keep it on the ground. And Booker tries to squirt free, still running, but he'll come up short of the first down. Now a flag comes in near the tackle. Do they get his face mask? Wolfpack pleading with the officials. Looks to be against them.
Drew! Hey, Drew! Face mask. 5 yards on the defense. Will be added on to first down.
We gotta pick up the pace here. Let's get the, we gotta get the officials picking up a little bit of pace here tonight.
You can coach him up at halftime.
Yeah, I may go down there at halftime. See if we can have a little discussion. A little face mask. They're gonna, now we'll see if they decide to pick it up here. They got their first down, but the clock's running.
Yeah, and with Littleton Littleton right here did wrong, but now they're just gonna, you would think, just take a knee. They're in the I formation here and be happy to get out of here with a 3-point lead. Nope. Instead, Weatherford will take a shot downfield, look for Carr. Well covered by Davis, they go up incomplete. Why not? Roll him to sleep and then throw it down to the 6'6 guy.
A.J. Davis and Greg Carr, the last couple plays, jawing back and forth, getting into a pretty good challenge here. And A.J. Davis is in great position. 3-year starter, had a hamstring that bothered him earlier in the year. He came back for the Boston College game. A veteran. He had 2 picks last year against Florida State, so he knows what it's like competing in these kind of games, and he's up to the challenge.
NC State coaches feel that he, Davis, and Jimmy Sutton both have kind of next-level ability, and the Wolfpack have sent corners to the league in years, too.
Oh, yeah.
So 9 seconds to go this time. Weatherford will just take a knee. They took their shot deep, didn't work out, and they'll go to the dressing room with a 3-point lead. Good first half. Some positive signs for young Daniel Evans at quarterback. Weatherford makes 2 big plays in the half, and that's enough for a 13-10 lead. And let's go down to Jerry Punch with Chuck Amato.
Coach, how would you assess the play of your young quarterback here in the first half?
Well, he made some big ones, and we had another one right there. We kind of dropped. It would have been a great catch. But he made some big plays, and he's playing smart.
Defensively, what concerns do you have about these first 30 minutes of football you just watched?
They came out running the ball, and then we knew that we thought they were going to do that, and then we slowed that down, and now they're going to go with the deep ones. We got to take a shot from them, and that's where Florida State is.
Hey, Coach, thanks for your time.
You're welcome.
Chris?
So some of you might take you the entire semester to get this, and quite frankly, others of you, it might take the term of your natural life. So does anybody have any ideas about how we're going to put all this information together? The answer is, college football lives here.
Welcome back to Raleigh for the second half. I hope that wasn't Chalk Talk in the locker room here. That was complicated stuff. There's a formula. Wolfpack greater than Seminoles.
There you go.
Was that your game plan at Ohio State with Weaves drawn up on the board there?
No, the calculus is more of our game plan in Columbus.
Oh, okay.
That's how we roll in Columbus.
Yeah, you try to tell me that you took calculus when you were at Ohio State.
I did.
Did you really?
Three semesters of it.
All right, calculate what's going to happen in the second half here. It's the Noles only have the five first downs, but it's been big plays by Weatherford enough to take the lead here.
I'm interested to see how both sides continue to attack here with a close game, because when both teams have been willing to take chances, it's worked out. Early, it was a little razzle-dazzle that was backfiring on Daniel Evans. And instead of that, they just decided to move eventually downfield and give him a chance to get back in rhythm and just attack. And that one drive, five plays and 80 yards, but sure, it took some help with some great plays downfield by his freshman receiver, Jerron James, and eventually another freshman, Donald Bowens, but they just got back and threw the ball downfield. So I think that's what you're going to see when they decide to be aggressive, attack downfield, and then try to mix in a little bit more of Andre Brown. And for Florida State, I think it's the same thing. When they are too conservative, there's no way they can run the football against this NC State defense.
Noles will get the football to begin the second half. It was good running early by Lorenzo Booker that set up the field goal. Then the run was shut down, and Booker became a good receiver, and he hauled in that big 62-yard pass from Weatherford to convert on third down. Durrani to boot it, and the Noles will get first crack at the football. That kick will go out of bounds off the flag, and the Noles will begin to get good field position. Back down to Jerry Punch.
Guys, at halftime, Bobby Bowden talked about trying to eliminate penalties in the second half. He said defensively, we were going to do some things to try to get more pressure on Daniel Evans, and they're killing us with the takeoff routes. That's what's really hurt us downfield. Now, offensively, he said, I'm frustrated by the missed opportunities. We're mixing up our plays pretty well, but we cannot take field goals, and we should be getting touchdowns that inside the red zone. Guys?
Six penalties in that first half for Bowden's team.
Yeah, and Doc, mixing up the play calls, I think as the game went on early, it was all about their running game, and they weren't having a lot of success. And as Doc said, I think they did a much better job of mixing it up. Once they got behind, then they started to be more aggressive.
Weatherford fires over the head of Carr and first down. Jimmy Sutton defending. Sometimes it's tough to figure out exactly what the Noles' identity is on offense, what they're trying to do. And it changes from series to series. Is that fair?
Yeah, it's fair. And I think that's the frustration for even Jeff Bowden. I mean, fans want to be critical of Jeff Bowden, but I think because there isn't consistency in a certain area, I think they've really struggled here to find out what is their strength. What is it that they know they can do well?
They motion Lorenzo Booker to the far left part of the formation. Weatherford looks immediately. They now fires in the slant. Almost intercepted. He was looking for Davis. Chris Davis and A.J. Davis was there on the coverage.
Everybody remembers Mark Richt, and it's something that Jeff Bowden hears about all the time. 94 to 2000, Mark Richt, who's now the Georgia head coach, as the offensive coordinator. He had three games where he had 300 yards, plus 300 yards passing, and Jeff Bowden has not had that. 249 yards a game through the air, and you can see the production with the numbers per game.
He played some tough teams, but 77 in total offense is not real good. On third down, they fire near side. It's Davis on Davis, incomplete, as A.J. broke it up against Chris.
This is, I think, a great example of when Mark Richt was there, a lot of times this play was made. I mean, and this has to do with A.J. Davis is a much better corner than who Florida State used to have to go up against. And maybe Chris Davis isn't quite as good as some of the receivers they used to have. So in the past, when Mark Richt was there, it wasn't real complicated. It was our athletes are going to be able to make plays. And now that's not so much the case in this conference in the ACC.
A.J. Davis, certainly a big-time athlete at corner.
Oh, yeah.
No, to punt it away. Blackman, who had the big kick return in the first half, calls for a fair catch, retreats to his 20. So the Noles waste pretty good field position to begin the second half, and now the Wolfpack will start from their 20.
Chuck Amato trying to get it started here, see what he can do with his first series. And he has so much respect for Jeff Bowden. This is Florida State in the pregame. That used to scare most teams, by the way, off the field. When that happened with Florida State, most teams in the ACC took off running. I'm talking about in the beginning of the ACC. Well, Chuck Amato brought that same walk and that same intimidation to the Wolfpack. I mean, watching these two teams in warm-ups, it's like looking into a mirror for these schools.
Wolfpack have a heck of an entrance with all the fireworks coming out there. Now Brown trying to create some fireworks into the secondary. Gets a block, gets across the 45. Brown, 26 yards. Recovered it there. Myron Roll there on the stop. Now Andre Brown starting to get loose.
Yeah, he is. And you know, it's surprising to me just because it's not as if NC State's done enough with their passing game consistently to make Florida State think, uh-oh, we've really got to be careful with Daniel Evans and his passing game. You know that Andre Brown is still the guy that they're going to try to get the football to. So I think the Noles knew it was coming, but that time they appeared to be off guard.
58 yards now for Brown. Gene comes in motion there, and they hand it off instead up the middle.
Number 22, Tony Baker carries the
Tony ball. Baker spelling Andre Brown. The theory was before the season to get Brown and Baker on the field at the same time. Two talented backs, both physical guys, both explosive, but they're not great pass blockers, and so that's been the problem when you put both of them on the field as opposed to a fullback out there or another tight end. They're not getting the pass protection they need. Second long, they hand it off to Brown, tries to bounce it left, nothing doing. Alex Boston and Andre Flewell on the tackles there, smothering things. Let's go to Jerry on the cerebral but far from geeky, according to Kirk, Mark Trestman.
Yeah, he may look like a software inventor, but he's got a pretty impressive resume. If you take a look at what he's done in the pros, you know, he led four NFL teams to playoffs in his very first year as an offensive coordinator. Look at the quarterbacks he had. Kosar, Steve Young, Jake Plummer, and Rich Gannon. And that's in the pros. And in college, he had guys like Bernie Kosar, Benny Testaverde, and Steve Walsh with the Hurricanes of Miami.
Way back, Trestman was a quarterback himself at the University of Minnesota. Third and long for Daniel Evans, who fires over the middle. Was there contact before the pass got there? Yes. Interference will be upcoming against the Noles. And that'll give NC State a first down.
McClure jumped the route, made the good read, but got in there way too early to defend Donald Bowens. Came right through Donald Bowens. Donald Bowens is a nice-looking freshman receiver. He comes across, and he gets hit by the safety who came up. But one thing he'll learn as he grows up as a receiver is instead of losing ground towards the line of scrimmage as a receiver, he needs to be coming back downhill when he runs his routes to give him his body a chance to protect himself from the football.
Without interference, it would have been a catch anyway, I think. Instead, it's first down to the 40 now. Nice little center step by Brown is in the secondary. Big physical guy with a burst inside the 25 before Buster Davis stops him.
He's running the football well, but James Newby, the left tackle, picks up a huge block on the linebacker Buster Davis to spring him loose. And the offensive lineman Leroy Harris downfield going to that second and even third level, picking up blocks downfield.
Brown off the 179-yard game a year ago against the Noles, starting to get it going. I formation, they pitch it to Brown. He beats Roll, who makes a good recovery to grab him by the ankles for a short gain. See the talented freshman Rover out there, the only man preventing a big gain from Brown.
Myron Roll, seeing him, Chris, in person down on the field. Just one of these guys who is a true freshman, blows you away with his physical size. Listed at 6'2", 218. He looks 6'4", 230 when you see him in person. Just an imposing, intelligent freshman.
Gifted and a desire to be great, too. Works hard.
Yep.
No sense of entitlement as a young, talented player coming in. It's complete. And Anthony Hill, the tight end, making people miss and muscling for a first down to the 12. Now they involve the leading receiver coming into this game, the big 277-pound tight end.
Well, that time, Roger Williams, a safety at 200 pounds, just doesn't have the strength to handle Anthony Hill at 280 pounds, 275 pounds for a tight end. This guy is a big man. He bounces off his leg and loses the shoe and still picks up the first down. You know, Hill last year was the second tight end to T.J. Williams, and with T.J. Williams off to the NFL, he's become the go-to guy and leading receiver for this Wolfpack offense.
First catch tonight, that's Baker in motion, but they hand it to Brown. A flag is down as Brown muscles into the end zone, but hold everything. It's in the holding zone. And then they put this celebration on hold. Now the band is playing and the wolf is howling in the PA here. But this one's coming back.
Right at the line of scrimmage, the left guard that time, Heppy just takes the nose guard and tackles. It just pushes him over and tackles him. It's a good call by the official to recognize that. Sometimes that gets lost because it was way behind the play, but it happened right after the ball was snapped. Chris, you're right. It seems like Andre Brown, even though that one got called back, starting to get into a little bit of a flow right now, feeling very comfortable going against this Noles defense. He told us yesterday, against the Noles, because of that speed, there's not a whole lot of time to dance around. You've got to get upfield in a hurry against their speed.
A huge difference. Set of 6 points. It's now first and 20 back at the 22. Play action, Evans. Well, tries to, and gets his face mask grabbed. That'll be the 15-yard variety there, no doubt, as Lawrence Timmons got him after a short gain. The kind of penalty that drives Bowden crazy because it wasn't necessary. He was headed out of bounds.
Boy, that, after you give up a touchdown, there's a holding call to give you a second life. That'll be a 15-yard personal foul.
And again, not needed because the quarterback was headed out of bounds. Timmons had him corralled.
Yeah, he was. Evans is just running out of bounds. Timmons is behind him.
That'll be tough in film study, especially if the Wolfpack punch it in here.
It's one thing to get out executed, but when you kill yourself, especially in your own red zone, it's the kind of plays that come back, obviously, to haunt you.
They hand it off to Baker. Baker breaks a tackle. Finally stopped at the 5. Darius McClure had him by the ankle. But a positive play on first and goal.
Well, you have the two backs between Tony Baker and Andre Brown. Brown has done so much work to bring him down here. Baker is a power back who can break tackles inside this area. He can stay fresh, and he comes in with a fresh set of legs.
This is where games like this are decided. Red zone opportunities. Can the Wolfpack cash in? They hand it ahead, and Baker lunges forward inside the 2. It'll set up a 3rd down. Buster Davis there on the stop, along with Roger Williams, and now it's the Noles defense that has to dig in to prevent the Wolfpack from taking the lead, and FSU will take a timeout. Mickey Andrews will set up at 3rd and goal defense. The importance of this play obvious to everybody. There's Mickey, 64 years old. He says you got to whisper in their ears sometimes to get their attention. He's a loud whisperer. Can his defense rise up? We'll find out when you come back to Raleigh. Game presented on ESPN HD, presented by Pioneer Door Plasma. Mickey Andrews over there on the Florida State sideline, gathering his defense. Little inspiration, little tough love from the 64-year-old as they better defend their goal line. NC State 2 yards away on 3rd down. What would you call here, Kirk?
They're going to go with a 2 tight end look here. Actually, 3 tight end look. You got to try to blow him off the ball and run your back Baker, or you go with the naked and roll the quarterback around the corner for a touchdown.
It's Baker, and he's not going to get there. The tank, Buster Davis, lost his helmet but flew in there and does what he does so well. Made a play.
Made a play, and he just has great instincts. Mickey Andrews says of all the linebackers that he's coached, this guy, Buster Davis, sees the field well. Watch him slide right behind that fullback. Just allows the fullback to get by, and that time, as Kane goes by him, he sneaks behind him and makes a great hit. Nice tackle there in the open field against a physical runner in Tony Baker.
He plays bigger than 5'10". He's probably not quite 5'10", to be honest with you. Leader out there, very smart player. And Buster Davis makes a huge play, and now a decision for the Wolfpack here on fourth down. Well, Saturday, ABC has a full afternoon of college football, 3:30 Eastern. Adrian Peterson tries to put himself in the front of the Heisman race and beat the Texas Longhorns in the Red River Rivalry, 8 o'clock Eastern. Presented by Southwest Airlines, two great regional matchups, Oregon, Cal, or Nebraska, Iowa State. So games at 3:30 and then 8 o'clock Eastern on ABC. We said that these kinds of situations down there on the goal line help decide these close defensive games. Now, a big decision for Amato against pretty good defense. Did he kick the field goal and tie it or take his chance right here?
I would take a chance. And the main reason I say that is you have a Florida State offense that's struggling. And if you take your shot, you try to get it into the end zone, and you come up short. Granted, Florida State celebrating, they're excited. But now the Noles offense is penned back into their own one-yard line. And now you can attack them on defense. So you got to go for it. You got to try to get points on the board right now and try to get touchdown.
They will go for it on fourth down, a little bit more than a yard. Can the Wolfpack take the lead right here? And will the Noles come up with a big stop? It's Baker in the eye. Gets the call. Dives toward the goal line. Don't think he got it. The officials will dive into that pile and check the spot. They'll mark him short of the goal line. And Mickey Andrews' defense has come up huge. Will they review it? The officials have spotted the ball inches from the goal line.
That is a very, very close call. And Baker, not known necessarily as a guy who's going to be able to get up, he takes off from about the 3.5-yard line.
Kind of bobbled the handoff a little bit.
Bobbled the handoff. He's got to extend the ball across the plane, and he does not, at least from that angle, he does not do that. The football never has a chance to get across, at least in the angle there. Boy, that's a good job by Florida State. Not only being able to get down low and make a play, but they noticed once he was elevated and laying on the pile, they didn't allow him to scoot forward. They kept pulling him back. The linebackers, Timmons and Buster Davis and Geno Hayes, who makes the initial contact, pulling him by the feet, not letting the football expose itself to get across the plane. His shoulder looked like it may have gotten across, but not the football.
That was Geno Hayes, the linebacker who we thought might have hurt himself earlier in the ballgame. He's given away about 20 pounds to the running back here.
This is a great angle right here. Geno Hayes makes the hit, the initial hit, and then the other linebackers, Timmons is there, Buster Davis is there. Look at the ball secured to his body. If it were in his right hand, initially, he might have had a chance to expose it again towards the plane, but it was not. It was tight to his body. It never got across the plane. So it was the initial hit and then the presence of mind to pull him back. It's one of those things that you work on all the time, one-on-one in practice. Teams all across the country work on that and take so much pride in that.
Had no idea how they would overturn a call on the field based on what we've seen, but they're being very cautious to review everything here now.
Which is great. You want to make sure of the call. Look at Timmons pulling him back. Pull him back.
Watch the reaction of Mickey Andrews after that timeout. Steadied his guys. He knew right away that stopped him short of the goal line, or at least he was hoping. Here comes the call.
On the field.
Call stands. Yeah, the mic is quit, but the call stands.
For a defensive coordinator, there's nothing more exciting than seeing your defense step up there inside that one-yard line and stop them short. And as I said, good call by Chuck Amato to go for it. Look where the football is, right on about the 2-inch line. Now you've got to attack this Drew Weatherford offense of Florida State.
Right in front of the student section down there, a foot off their own goal line. The Noles will throw it. Weatherford has time, flips it over the middle, caught by the tight end. Now the ball's loose. It's a scramble. The Noles have come up with the loose ball. It was Dunham. They'll rule it Florida State football, and Brandon Warren, the freshman tight end, as you can see, Jeff Bowden unafraid to throw from his end zone.
I was going to say, for all the cynics out there on Jeff Bowden, I love the play call on first and 10, taking a chance, showing confidence. A nice job by Booker as the end came up. He knocked him down. The ball came loose, but it's a great call. Backed up into his own one-yard line, throws the football to get it out of there. Being aggressive by Jeff Bowden.
And now the Noles misfire on the offensive line. Yeah, Booker really did a heck of a job there. He's not the biggest back, but he did a great job. Just stoned the pass rusher.
Well, the mic's killing us tonight here.
You don't need the mic. That's, no, that's your basic false start there. Yeah. Dead ball, five yards, repeat first down.
How about Andre Brown, who obviously wants to have a chance to get in there? He's their go-to man. Fourth and one. He wants to be on the field. He's a competitor. He wants to be on the field to have a chance. He had a lot to do with getting him down there. He's got to keep his cool now, and he's a competitor. He wants to be out there, but Tony Baker got the chance.
All backs say, we don't mind rotating. There's plenty of carries for everybody, but it's carries like that that he wants to be on the field. This time it's Booker getting the football. And first and long, the Wolfpack defense, a good job plugging the gap. At the bottom down there, one more time, Tank Tyler.
When you're North Carolina State, every opportunity matters. They took their shot. They came up a little bit short. The last thing that Chuck Amato can do right now is to allow his defense to get their head down a little bit and give up a first down or two or three. At the very least, they've got to keep this Florida State offense pinned back and get good field position again for their offense.
Once again, four men in motion. And it's Dakota Fagg coming to the near side of the formation. Rutherford gives to Booker. They're testing the center of that NC State defense. That's the strength of this defense. Presley and Tyler once again providing no running room.
Old Tank Tyler in the inside there has tremendous strength, and right now is just owning the Florida State offensive line.
Doc, what do you think about the guy who benches 525?
I tell you guys, I talked to some NFL scouts up in the press box, including Bill Polian, president of the Colts. He said, we're here to see Tank Tyler. He is a force in the middle.
Doc, he's had a great game tonight.
Rutherford fires over the middle, caught once again, first down. And all of a sudden, Brandon Warren, the tight end, and Bowden said you can't ignore the tight end at Florida State anymore. This young guy is a great receiver.
Well, the other thing that's happening is that on third down and so far to go, you had the North Carolina State defense way off the line of scrimmage, giving Brandon Warren plenty of time to make a move. All he did, nothing fancy. He got to the first down marker, turned around. Weatherford had time to throw, and his go-to man right now with a hot hand is Brandon Warren.
Jeff Bowden had hoped to create some coverage mismatches with his freshman tight end. He's getting him now. Three catches for Warren. Now, Weatherford fires near side. Carr, jump ball. And the big guy gets it, gets drilled. But the catch takes the Noles into NC State territory. Heath with the hit. And the jump ball over A.J. Davis.
What he did here is before he had a chance to go up is he got himself in position. He goes to the outside. He wants the ball thrown. But great position by Davis. Right there, he moves to the inside to get the position that he needed to go up and over A.J. Davis. It's almost just boxing out in basketball, getting position and then going up and taking advantage of your size. And there's a big hit here. There, he's lucky to hold on to the football.
Basketball is not that kind of contact sport, is it? 23 yards on the game.
Another first and 10 play action throw by Jeff Bowden.
He's got the tight end again. And this time a nice job on the tackle by DeJuan Morgan. You could see the speed of Warren, though, as he moved toward the sideline making that catch.
Well, Brandon Warren is a future superstar for this Florida State offense. 6'2", about 235 pounds. But I love DeJuan Morgan. On the other side, watch him close in on the big tight end and make an open field tackle. Gives up some size there, but he's very aggressive.
If he didn't make that tackle, it's a huge game. So second and long. More motion tonight than we're used to seeing from the Seminoles. They very often had four men in motion. After all that, a basic handoff to Booker up the middle. Miguel Scott makes the stop. So Florida State, after making that huge stop on fourth down on their goal line, an impressive drive as they try to build on a three-point lead here midway third quarter. The Noles already with a conference loss at home to Clemson. Cannot afford another one. And NC State's defense, Kirk, has to rise up here on third and five.
Third and five, because of the momentum and because of what's happened here in the last few plays. Big, big play, and we're going to get another timeout.
See if the Noles can keep this march going. If they could put it in the end zone on this drive, that would be a very deflating blow to the Wolfpack. NC State needs a stop right here on Bowden's team.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Nissan, proud presenter of the 2006 Heisman. Visit theheismanvote.com to cast your vote. And Under Armour Performance, the advantage is undeniable.
The bell tower here on the NC State campus. See if they can find a bell cow on defense right now, because NC State needs a stop, and the crowd waving towels involved here. Empty backfield for Weatherford.
Keep an eye on number one, Brandon Warren. Three catches already in this drive. Kind of the go-to guy, the hot hand here on third down.
And it's Carr on the near side with single coverage. Weatherford flips it near side. It's Booker instead. A lot of weapons to use, and Booker beat his man. Easy game for the first down.
It's actually a rub route here. They use Brandon Warren to get into the way of the linebackers. They've played, North Carolina State plays so much man coverage. This time, Brandon Warren does a good job getting vertical, and in the process, Rump, the linebacker, didn't have time to get out there to stay with Lorenzo Booker. Another well-designed play for the Noles to pick up that first down.
They have nine first downs tonight, one via penalty, the other eight all by passing. No first downs running the ball. Booker's fourth catch. This time, Booker has it on the end around. Man to beat, steps inside of the defender there, Garland Heath, before Raymond Brooks, the defensive end, brings him down.
Such a versatile back. He had the big play, of course, the broken play by Weatherford, but all purpose, he's coming up with plays.
He needed 52 coming in. Now he has 2,000 yards rushing in his career. I think there were some who felt he might be a 2,000-yard rusher in a season when he first got to Florida State. It's taken him 4 years to get to 2K.
Couldn't you just see him at the next level having success, gets into the right offense?
This time it's Smith spelling him in a short game. Sure, over the years, there have been plenty of Florida State backs who have been, you know, less than super productive in college, but gone on to have huge careers in the pros. Guys like, you know, William Floyd, who played fullback, of course, but running backs as well.
Yeah, I think he has a chance because he can catch the football. I think that aspect of his game, there's so many specialists in the NFL. You get to a right offense where you can match up against a linebacker one-on-one, he can make a lot of people miss. It's another third down here for Florida State.
And again, they've gone to the air every time they've needed a third down and gotten all of them. They fire near side. Going up and making the catch is Dakota Fagg, his first catch of the night, first down at the 22 before Neal stopped him. So they're spreading the ball around now on this drive.
North Carolina State is doing a good job on defense, but my gosh, it's third and three. There's the first down line. They have the corners bailing. I just don't understand that. It's you're just giving Florida State a first down. Look at the cushion that you're giving to the Florida State wide receivers. You might as well just say, hey, fellas, go ahead. I'll tell you what, we're enjoying watching this drive. Go ahead, take the first down.
You would not coach that technique for Neal there.
No, not on third and three.
They're 3-for-3 on third down in this drive. Weatherford goes over 200 yards passing. A reverse again. Davis squeezes between two defenders, gets near the first down marker at the 12 before Gray and Morgan combine.
This is a play that earns a quarterback high marks in the film room. Right here, getting a chance to pick up a block on Young, the defensive end, who was fooled. And just by catching him and catching his knee, he'll go into the film room, and the running backs and receivers will see that, and they appreciate that he's willing to get dirty for his guys.
The defensive end might remember that one, too, as he goes right for the knee and then block.
Could be filed away. Could be.
This place, this drive started on their, what do you think, their own two-inch line?
Yeah. We said what a deflating this drive would be.
Something about us in third quarters and people possessing the ball. Tommy Tuberville didn't want to give the ball back once to Steve Spurrier. Tommy Tuberville coming out and saying some things that I think, I don't want to speak for you, but I know I agree with, about the SEC and how tough it is to get through the SEC.
You used the P word, the playoff, which I've been,
you've been
talking about for a long time.
Yeah.
Weatherford throws for the end zone. Carr can't get it. Threw it over his head. Davis with good coverage. Carr didn't run a kind of fade route toward the pylon. He was kind of shallow in that, huh?
Well, once he runs his route, and the ball is always going to be thrown on a fade like that over your outside shoulder, right away you've got to work back out to the outside. The corners are going to try to push you in, but work now. Work right away. Realize that the ball is going to be thrown to the back pylon, and as soon as you get to the inside, start working back out. That time he put himself in a terrible position.
Davis, a nice job though in single coverage, disrupting the timing. Weatherford has it this time, man, wide open, touchdown. And there's the freshman tight end. The first of perhaps many touchdown receptions in his Florida State career. What a drive, 99 yards.
And give Drew Weatherford a lot of credit, give this Florida State offense a lot of credit, but give the much maligned Jeff Bowden a lot of credit for being aggressive with the play call. That time, DeJuan Morgan, who's had such a great night as a safety, got overly aggressive. And there's Jeff Bowden right here in the middle. Got overly aggressive, out of position, and look who he left all alone. Brandon Warren, who had a great drive right there for the Noles.
He'd been kind of quiet. He was open in the end zone earlier, and the great play by Patrick Lowry prevented a touchdown. But this, the first of his career, and what a march for the Noles as they follow the goal line stand with a 99-yard marathon march to go up by 10 here in Raleigh. Line drive, kick sails out of bounds. So, Wolfpack will begin with good field position.
Chris, this is a pretty play. Man-to-man coverage here. Brandon Warren against DeJuan Morgan. Just done such a good job as a safety. But this time, bites on the play action right here. Look at the receiver coming around to fake. And this is where they get caught. Morgan just gets caught, left all by himself in the end zone as the tight end Brandon Warren.
A little fake reverse, what earned him that space. Doc, this guy's a very impressive-looking tight end out of Alcoa, Tennessee, right near Knoxville.
And, Chris, that's about 7 miles from the University of Tennessee campus. Heavily recruited by Tennessee. Verbally committed early, though, to Florida State and kept his commitment.
Tight end has never been, you know, a big part of the offense down here, Kirk. You wouldn't say that a young tight end with NFL aspirations, and this guy has that, would choose Florida State, but they sold him on kind of becoming a bigger part of the offense.
Well, that's an aspect of this offense that, you're right, we've not seen for a number of years, but definitely when you include him, and right now you look on your depth chart, you're looking at guys who can make plays. Brandon Warren has to be one of the first guys you're circling when it comes to Weatherford throwing.
They hand it to Brown. Wolfpack for the first time tonight down by more than one score. We'll see how patient they can be. Roll and Davis combining on the stop. It'll be third and short.
Well, patience at this point is still essential. I know we're getting under 3 minutes here in the third quarter, but Mark Trestman, the previous drive when they went all the way down inside that 1 yard line, a lot of it had to do with spreading things out and running Andre Brown.
They were not able to come up with the key conversions on third and fourth and goal, and now they need 3 yards to prolong the drive. Jamil Eugene and Brown are in there. It's Evans firing short, complete. Eugene has it, and a lot of room. A great block, Jamil Eugene bursting down near the 20. So not just a key conversion, but a huge play. 36 yards sets him up.
Confusion this time by Lawrence Timmons, the linebacker. He looked a little indecisive on what to do. Keep an eye on him. I think he's a little bit confused on, do I cover the running back, slip it out of the backfield, Eugene? And then he obviously should have. He's left all alone. And then Eugene, the freshman, gets into the open field. A little bit of a stiff arm there to pick up another 10 yards.
And Anthony Hill, the tight end, threw a nice block. No, within 10 yards of Eugene on that conversion.
Timmons should have been in coverage that time he rushed.
First catch for the third back in this offense. Pump fake from Evans. Plenty of time. Lofts it down there. Incomplete. Coming over was Michael Ray Garvin to knock it away from Jerrin James.
Watching Daniel Evans, he looks like a different quarterback, you know, now in the second half. I asked him yesterday when he was playing against Boston College in his first start, I said, you know, was it fast? Was it slow, the defense you're looking at? He said, the first half, I could barely see the defense. They were moving around so fast. He said, by the second half, things started to slow down a little bit, and I could make my reads. The same thing tonight. Very, very quick early, making some poor decisions, but has really settled in, showing great patience in the pocket.
Low snap, they hand it to Brown. Bursts up the middle. Cuts to his left. Brown headed for the pylon before he slips down at the four. Garvin, the corner, brought him down. 17 yards. You see the quickness of this big 230-pounder.
He's another guy I was impressed with when he walks in, looking like he's an Ivy Leaguer with the way he dressed coming into our meeting. I think the snap drew the defense towards the football. He accelerated through the hole, but what he really did was he made the cutback with the vision, almost got around the corner from Garvin to take it into the end zone. Let's see if they take Andre Brown out of the lineup this time, where he got so frustrated that Tony Baker went in for him.
He's a yard short of 100 yards rushing. The Wolfpack will have to spend a timeout here.
Keep him on the field. What do you think?
I agree. Baker's a very good short yardage player. You could debate.
But you go with a hot hand, I think. I mean, the second half, Andre Brown's been very effective.
Yeah. I'm going back to the play.
Baker's a great player, but right now.
I got you. Talked about the great weekend in the SEC. The Volunteers go between the hedges in prime time on ESPN in high definition. Quarterback play has been a problem for the Dogs. Eric Ainge riding a wave of confidence. College football lives here. All games on ESPN and ESPN2 are available in high definition. Volunteers are road favorite.
Yeah, but Georgia's won 5 the last 6. Get Joe Tereshinski back. Settle down that offense. Great defense. You think old Tennessee tough enough to go to Athens and win that game?
Well, the Dogs need to find a running game, my friend.
Yeah, but it helps to find a running game when you can throw the football to push a defense back a little bit, and that's what they'll have to do against Tennessee. I think Tennessee backs against the wall.
Well, you're giving me an early lean, but we'll save it for game day. Jerry, give us an injury update.
Guys, a moment ago, Jamel Eugene made that reception with a separated shoulder. They sent him off at halftime for x-rays of his clavicle, thinking his collarbone was broken. They say it's a first-degree separation of the shoulder. He wanted to come back into play and made the reception down the field. And by the way, defensively, we are being told that Tank Tyler is having back spasms and may not play much, if any, the remainder of the night.
Boy, that would be a loss to defensive leader, the big tackle.
That's big. I should mention, we just talked about Andre Brown going into the game. He's in the game, but so is Tony Baker. Both in the game here. See what Mark Trestman has in mind, putting both them inside this 5-yard line.
First and goal. They fake it to Brown, and Evans, trying to squirt free, fights to get back to the line of scrimmage. Darryl bursting in there.
Well, I think we know what he had in mind there. That's using your backs as decoys and trying to catch them off guard by keeping the ball in the hands of Daniel Evans. Knowles all over it.
Evans not known for great quickness as a runner. They were hoping the deception would get him into the end zone. But they got on second down. Brown is in the game to the right of Evans. But Evans, the flags fly before the snap, shows the frustration, and then he'll move him back 5 yards.
The right side of the line, I think, going on the snap count, and Leroy Harris, the center, for getting to get the ball up.
Mm. Coach Herb Street, it's red zone execution that's been the problem for the Pack here in the second half. You know, Amato knows you get so few opportunities to beat a team like Florida State, you got to cash him in. Now it's going to be second and goal back at the 10.
You got to come up with a new name for Chuck the Chess there. I think he's dropping some LBs there.
He's not going through a bulking phase. He's cutting.
Yeah, he's trimming back.
Yeah.
High reps.
It's Brown in the backfield. Evans looks to the corner. High throw, caught. Touchdown. Another nice throw from this young quarterback in a pressure situation. And Jaron James, as Dad looks on, proud of Evans.
Now, Pop should be real happy of his son and the way he makes this throw. A little pump fake to the inside, to the slant, to James, and then it takes time to be able to execute the double move. The ball thrown right where it has to be, right over the shoulder of James. And James, another freshman, extends the arms for an apparent touchdown.
Here comes the review.
I guess they're going to look at it.
Here comes the review.
Thought he got his right foot down.
They're going to be extra cautious here tonight in the
ACC.
Okay.
That's okay. We appreciate that. Watch the punt move right there. Caught the corner. Garvin out of position. He goes down, and now it's just a matter of putting the ball where your receiver can make a catch. That is a perfect throw. He catches the football and gets his right foot down. This will be a great look at it right here. Ball is caught. Right foot is down. That's a touchdown for the Wolfpack.
Are they getting carried away reviewing plays that seem to be obvious in your mind?
Yeah, there we go. You know, I don't mind if they review it when it's a quick draw McGraw like that. I like that. Boy, what a throw. Daniel Evans making a few throws tonight to impress you.
And they've looked for playmaking receivers here, and the redshirt freshman James has stepped forward.
So is Donald Bowens on the other side. And what an answer to that long drive by Florida State.
You thought that a goal line stand and then a 99-yard march by the Noles might be the dagger in this team, but instead, NC State responds, cuts the lead back to 3. Evans has been impressive. I don't think either of us expected him to be that effective tonight in the second start.
No way. And the offensive line of North Carolina State, I think, deserves a lot of credit because they have held the rush out for the most part to give him time. And when he has time to throw and he sets his feet, he makes some very good throws. And all of a sudden you start to think about all the pressure on the outside of the North Carolina State program taking on one of the best teams, if not the best team in the ACC, Chris. Daniel Evans is a sophomore. Donald Bowens, one of the receivers, is a freshman. Andre Brown, the great back. Jamel Eugene made a big play. Tony Baker. All these guys are either a sophomore or freshman. And also we've seen, again, Jaron James, number 88, all over the field making plays. All these players are either redshirt freshman, true freshman, or sophomore.
Talked to the AD, Lee Fowler, no relation today, about a motto and all the heat that comes from the media and some of the fans here at NC State does not translate into real job jeopardy for Chuck Amato at this point. I mean, Fowler hasn't come out and given a very public vote of confidence because he doesn't want to dignify Amato's critics, but he said he's never considered making a change and he thinks the program's in a great direction. He respects Amato's love for his alma mater, so the hot seat is really a misused term when it comes to this guy. Knowles will have a chance on the kick return. Jocelyn Shaw hammered as he crosses the 20.
Just take that step, that point one step further, Chris. Last year, this NC State team started 2-4. They were undisciplined, making a lot of mistakes, a lot of pressure, very similar to what you're seeing this year. Fowler then did come out and say, hey, you know, wait a second. This is our guy. We like the direction that he's going. And they won 5 of their last 6 games and went to a bowl game. So this is a swing game, in my opinion, after what happened in Boston College. This could send their year, if they're able to pull this out, in a whole different direction than I think what people expected 2 or 3 weeks ago.
So a lot on the line in the final 15 minutes. Can NC State rally once again on its home field? Will the Noles dodge a second ACC loss? It's all on the line when you come back for the final quarter from Raleigh. Set for the fourth quarter here at Carter-Finley Stadium. The Wolfpack have answered the touchdown drive by the Seminoles back to a 3-point game. As the Noles begin from their 22-yard line, Drew Weatherford, one of our impact players tonight, is 7 for 11 passing in the second half. And Lorenzo Booker has been a huge impact with a buck 57.
Yeah, it's been a big night, obviously, for Booker. Weatherford, that last drive was sensational. And Buster Davis making plays and forcing the Pack to have to throw the football to move it.
Anton Smith is the back behind Weatherford on first down. Weatherford still has it. Pressure fires downfield behind the tight end. That time the freshman was well covered by DeJuan Morgan, the safety, and Weatherford pressured by Willie Young.
At times, Weatherford still shows his age. He's been out there so much the last couple years. Right now, he needs to look back to his tight end, Brandon Warren. Brandon Warren was open for about the first 3 seconds when he made the turn. He just waited so long, it gave the North Carolina State defense time to come over and get to Brandon Warren and put pressure also on Weatherford.
There's that speedy beanpole. Willie Young making the play again. Another freshman. We've seen freshmen all over the field for both teams tonight. Weatherford fires over the middle, almost intercepted by Morgan again. And all of a sudden, the pressure beginning to get to Weatherford. He's misfired a couple of times. Back to Reese Davis for a 30-30.
All right, Chris, Mets behind six shutout. Tom Glavine leading the Dodgers 4-0 in the seventh. Tigers beat up on New York's other team. Imagine calling the Yankees that. Didn't beat up on them, but beat them 4-3 to even the series at a game apiece as they head back to Detroit. Cardinals beat the Padres 2-0. St. Louis leads that series now 2-0. Much more on SportsCenter coming up after the game and ESPN News. As all, the breaking news instantly.
Reese, thank you. It's loud as Weatherford wants a timeout on 3rd and 10. This place has come alive. That drive by the Wolfpack to stay in this game. And then an excellent start to this series by the defense, forcing 3rd and long. And now the crowd on its feet all over the place. Talked about the youth of Florida State. We lost a bunch of guys to the NFL, including some juniors. 58 players per game, 38 of them freshmen or sophomores. And that is the last time out for the Noles.
Yeah, and only one left for North Carolina State. We're just starting the fourth quarter. And there's been a lot of confusion here and some crucial plays that have caused Bobby Bowden and Chuck Amato to use their timeouts. The Noles now are out, and NC State has won. That's something, if this game stays close, becomes important. And sure. You look back and you think, why weren't we able to hold on to a couple of those?
That probably was a well-used timeout. You don't want confusion on 3rd and 10, and the Pack has been bringing pressure. Weatherford's been misfiring just a bit. Our Applebee's weekend menu. Talked about the excellent slate of games. LSU and Florida will be there in Gainesville for College Game Day, the Red River rivalry on ABC. Tennessee and Georgia's an ESPN primetime game. 3rd and 10. The crowd trying to help the defense. Weatherford, pressured, stopped. DeMario Presley, his 3rd sack of the season. They'll punt.
This stadium is coming alive and starting to rock, and the energy is being felt.
Hey, Willie, get in the weight room before you start flexing, huh?
That's your guy right there, Willie Young. What a stop for the Wolfpack. Momentum, obviously, in the favor of the Red.
And we'll see if Darrell Blackman can create a big play with the punt return. Nice boot, really pushing Blackman back inside the 30, but he's got some room. Able to get across the 40 to the 43. Let's update the impact players for NC State. Again, a pleasant surprise tonight from the second time starter, Daniel Evans.
Look at the numbers, 10 of 17. You think, you know what, that's okay. Second career start against the Florida State defense. Hasn't made many mistakes at all. Andre Brown has come alive in the second half. I'm sure you'll see a lot of him here on this drive. And Tank Tyler has been tough and physical against that Seminole offensive line. All three having a big impact tonight.
Brown and Baker flanking Evans on first down. It's Brown who gets the call at the middle. Here's the burst, accelerates into the secondary inside the 45 before Rolls stopped him. Leroy Harris, the center, sprung him, Kirk.
You talk about getting into a zone in any sport you might play. Andre Brown right now is feeling it. He's in a zone. He's over 100 yards, and it's the same play almost every time, a zone play out of the shotgun. The offensive line, by the way, deserves a lot of credit, too. They are getting a good push and getting up to the linebackers to give him room to run. Good look at back. He has amazing acceleration for his size.
Yet another four-quarter fist fight for Bowden's team. It's Brown. That time they smother him at the line of scrimmage. Good job, interior line. Everett Brown, another freshman, true freshman.
We've
seen nothing but freshmen on both sides, offense and defense. I mean, they feel here at NC State that this team is certainly a year away from being as good as they can be, and this is something of a transition year for the Noles as well.
But in a game like this, especially if it ends up going your way, you grow up in a hurry because of the intensity of this football game.
Second and 12, Evans fires over the middle and over the head of the receiver, almost intercepted. Roger Williams was there. He was looking for Anthony Hill. Williams had a chance on the tip.
Actually, not a bad throw by the quarterback, but again, it's going to be third down here.
Tressman's team just 2 for 9 on third down. It's been a struggle for most teams against the Seminoles and a struggle for NC State against most teams converting on third down. Barrett in the slot, Jaron James at the top of the formation. Low snap again. Evans looks over the middle, complete. Caught by Dunlap. And he's right near the marker at the 33 as Williams stopped him. Nice little route by the X wide receiver. Plays that position in this offense over the middle.
And the tight end Hill clears out the defensive back right here. By doing this and going out here, look at the room and look at the window and the cushion that is there for the quarterback to make the throw in there that time to Dunlop.
Looks like he did get the first down, judging by our yellow line. Talked about the struggles on third down. That's an enormous conversion for this team, which struggles in that area. Easily.
You know what? It's a different, it's almost like you can take those stats from this year, put them on a piece of paper, wad them up, and throw them in the trash, only because it's a different deal now with Daniel Evans, a quarterback. You have a chance. With Marcus Stone, nice guy. He's working hard. He knows the system. Just they weren't completing passes, let alone converting on third down. With what we've seen with Daniel Evans, he gives you a chance on not only third down, but any down to throw the football.
Dunlap in motion. They give it off to Baker. Baker shoots into the secondary, picks up close to 9. Noles losing their heads all of a sudden. They appeared to have control of this game just a few minutes ago.
Well, you can't arm tackle Tony Baker with a fresh set of legs in a fourth quarter, and that's what they tried to do there. Yet Buster Davis tried it. He's getting blocked. He tries to put his arms out there. He loses his helmet.
How many times he lost his hat tonight? Yeah. Buster, get a new chin strap, my friend. But about 3 times.
How about the combo again with Andre Brown and then Tony Baker coming in with the power?
Baker with the power again, gets the first down. He's just dragging Buster Davis forward. Now is when having that tailback tandem, two strong physical guys also with the burst, really pays off in the fourth quarter.
Well, it's paying off, and we've talked about Brown having a hot hand, but Baker's come in with some crucial carries, and it's staying fresh and also just staying hungry. When you get your chance, you're going to run as hard as you can to show what you can do. But I want to go back to the offensive line and the way they're controlling that line of scrimmage, getting a great push against the Noles.
Baker still in the game. The two killer bees have combined for 152 yards, and Baker trying to add to that total. Picks up about 4 over the left side. But again, it's going to come down to red zone execution. Evans able to come up with a touchdown pass the last time down here. As the Seminole was down on the field, we go down to Jerry.
Guys, you talk about the power backs that NC State has in Tony Baker and Andre Bound. Pound for pound, they are two of the strongest football players on this Wolfpack team. Baker has a 450-pound bench press for a running back. That is third highest on the team. And then, of course, Brown is no slouch at 415 pounds. And get this, guys, Baker has a 335-pound power clean. That is the best of all the Wolfpack players, offense, defense, anyone on the team. He is incredibly strong for his size.
Each of those guys, Brown and Baker, were North Carolina Players of the Year in successive years. Brown having to sit out a year. Baker is the younger guy. And I'll tell you how that translates, how that strength translates. Yeah. As we see Andre Flewellen as the player down, the defensive tackle for Florida State. How that translates into football, a guy like Baker had 37 carries coming into this game, Kirk. Defenses had stopped him for a total of 7 yards in losses. I mean, it's so hard to bring the guy down.
And I think that's the thing that he takes so much pride in. What I love to see is the fact that they cheer one another on. They're competitors. They want to get out on the field. But at the same time, that must be their sign for we got it on a roll right now. Let's keep going with it. But it's not one of those things that when the other guy gets in, it's, oh, man, let me stay in the game. It's cheering the next guy on. And see, Baker had the hot hand. He comes off, and now it's Andre Brown's shot again.
Well, Brown was a little bit upset earlier when he didn't get the call.
Well, the fourth and one. Yeah. Yeah, he wanted it.
Booker looks on. Second and five. Evans will throw to the end zone. Jump ball. Touchdown! Touchdown, John Dunlap! Johnny Evans looking on his kid, another great throw. Huh?
Dad looks pretty happy. The color analyst here for the Wolfpack. I'll tell you what, Chris, Daniel Evans, how do we say this politically correct? He has some guts. He has guts and courage to sit in there and put that ball where he just put it.
And you know, Kirk, that's the same pitch and catch combo.
Yep.
And the same part of the end zone as that play against BC that will live forever in NC State football history. Again, we go back to that one play that pulled out a victory a week ago and has put him in position for perhaps another huge rally here. NC State has the lead, 10:36 to play. That may be getting carried away. A couple of weeks ago, Daniel Evans was known as a popular local hero, high school product, whose dad, Johnny, played quarterback here back in the day and as a radio color guy. But in the last couple of weeks, suddenly, he's emerged as a major hero. And Evans to Dunlap, which was not a pitch and catch combo on the lips of any NC State fan, has become the connection. And NC State has the lead as the Noles get the football back. Joslyn Shaw has room near sideline. Steps out of bounds across the 30. Now it's up to the NC State defense. Did it last time, forcing them three and out to stop them again.
Chris, this is the play again. The throw is amazing, but the catch by Dunlap, that's great coverage by the freshman Patrick Robinson, but Dunlap just goes up and over him and makes a great catch. Another good job of adjusting. And this is going back to the Boston College game. Basically, the last play of the game, their last hope, and Evans puts it up into the same end zone, the same spot, and my man John Dunlap again goes up and over defender to make a catch. Something about that corner you want to keep an eye on if you're defending the pack.
Evans can throw that route. We've learned that. What can Weatherford do now as the crowd gets loud on first down? Drew trying to buy some time. Well, he pointed to an open spot in the field of the freshman tight end. It's incomplete as Warren couldn't quite corral it. Well covered by Scott and Lowry that time. Jerry, you've seen this young guy Evans, a guy you've known for a while, really emerge tonight.
And Chris, you know, despite passing for almost 10,000 yards in high school and his dad being an All-American here, he wasn't guaranteed a scholarship. He was told if one of the guys they offered didn't take it, they would call him. Well, on signing day, Brent Schaefer from South Florida opted to go to Tennessee, and they called the young man on the morning of signing day and said, you're going to come play here. We think you got a shot. How about that for a last-minute find?
Best known as the holder for field goals until the last couple of games. On second down, Weatherford pressured.
tries to escape, eventually brought for a huge loss. They brought pressure from every place that time. It was Garland Heath early, and then Teddy Larson there to clean it up, 11-yard loss. All of a sudden, Steve Dunlap, has begun to confuse that offensive line with the pressure.
Well, Lowry, Chris, gets in there. I think Weatherford just felt the pocket caving in on him. He tried to keep his focus downfield, but there was nobody open, and that pocket just closed in on him until finally Heath got to him, missed him, but the defensive line was there to clean it up the rest. Another freshman, Teddy Larson, in on that play.
Third down and long, they just hand it to Booker. He bolts up the middle. Flags fly. He's well short of the first down. Scott on the stop. Didn't get the snap off in time. Yeah, well, we don't need the mic. The signal is obvious, but it's going to make it even tougher on third and long. And Bobby's got the headset on. That's not a good sign, Kirk.
Nope.
He puts those headsets on and supervises, or at least listens in to what his son is calling upstairs. Over the years, that's not a great sign. It usually means he's in a conservative mindset, but they don't want to gamble down here on third and a mile. And it will be a handoff. Booker just dives ahead. That's kind of a give-up play to avoid further bleeding. And once again, the NC State defense, after allowing that 99-yard drive, has really come up big the last two possessions.
That's a great point, because you thought you're really going to find out what NC State was made out of. But I thought the fact their offense came right back down and answered gave their defense kind of second wind and confidence that they can get back into this game. Once Weatherford was sacked on second down, I think Florida State said, let's just hand it off, live to fight another day here as we get down to the 8-minute mark.
Blackman, a very short kick. Kind of hits it off the side of his foot. And the roll moves the ball to the 47. But now, after just a 32-yard punt, NC State takes over halfway through the fourth quarter with the lead, in great field position, and the wind at their back.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Applebee's Neighborhood Grill and Bar. Eating good in the neighborhood, Applebee's. And in part by Singular, raising the bar.
Three possessions for NC State in this second half, Kirk. The long march down to the one, and then consecutive touchdown drives. Great field position as they protect a four-point lead. And they're going to throw on first down. Evans takes a shot downfield, up in the air, and caught! Jaron James! What an aggressive call by Tressman. They're going for the jugular here.
We're seeing an entire NC State offense mature right before our eyes tonight with some of these throws and some of these catches. Nice throw, but again, puts it up in the air and allows his bigger receiver to go up and make a catch. It's a freshman going up and over another freshman for Florida State to make a big catch. What a coming out party tonight for Jaron James.
First down inside the 30. It's Brown. Patiently awaiting for some to open up, and now trying to muscle around the corner for a few yards. Well, what a night it's been for Daniel Evans in his second career start. By far, biggest game, biggest stage. But can he finish? This is pregame. That's the motto on his T-shirt. Three touchdown passes to three different receivers. Better than anybody could have imagined against a pretty stout defense. But now, 7:13 to go to finish the job.
This program has been on the doorstep before. It's a matter of stepping through. This is a great moment, not only for Daniel Evans and this team, but this program for Chuck Amata.
Brown, nowhere to go. Everett Brown, another true freshman, there to stop the sophomore Brown for a loss.
This is a team that lost, remember, on its home field, Akron. Lost big, dominated physically at Southern Mississippi. And then had a chance to start over in conference play. Beating BC and trying to pull off a second home field upset here tonight.
I think that was Chuck Amato's selling point to his team, was the non-conference slate is out of the way. Let's get serious and let's go to work in the ACC.
They're in field goal range for John Duraney, who's kicked one from 54 and has a big win at his back here. Let's see how cautiously they play it. The snap bounced to Evans, who scrambles up and now flips it complete. A flag flies. It's a first down to Donald Bowens at the 15-yard line. Now we'll check the marker. Pack signaling that it's against the Noles. But it's offensive pass interference. Never trust a player in that situation. He'll call back what was a huge completion on third and 10. Chuck, the wry smile. He's had his problems with the officials this season. SportsCenter to follow this game. Update you on the shocker in the Bronx, all the divisional series in baseball. College football as well, as you look ahead to the weekend. Immediately following the final 6:21. This is an enormous penalty because not only do they not get the first down to the 15-yard line, Kirk, it's back at the 44 and they're out of field goal range.
Goes without saying that it's a big blow for NC State, but now if you're Florida State, you see third and 25. Boy, now you want to try to really take advantage of this opportunity, bring some pressure, try to create some havoc, and try to get all over Daniel Evans. That was the biggest break and not the only break at that point that Bobby Bowden could have gotten.
29 yards. That's the impact of that penalty. Third and 25. Evans rolls, time runs out, flips it downfield, just tosses it at the bench. If they take it a knee on third and 10, Duraney's in field goal range. But the penalty pushes him back. A flag is down again in the area near the offensive line.
Well, the offensive, you know, the receiver was downfield, John Dunlop, 20 yards downfield, blocking a Florida State defensive back. The Florida State coaches are upset on the other sideline for good reason. Dunlop is actually literally blocking. I think he thought maybe the play was called a quarterback sweep. He was blocking the whole way downfield.
Well, borrowed band from North Carolina Central getting in on the action here. Again, Florida State not traveling its band. Look at the cheerleaders in front down here, the band all getting into the tomahawk chop. They've earned their little meal money in the free t-shirts they got.
No doubt about that. They've been working all night, doing a great job. Noles are going to decline this penalty, set up fourth down, get the ball back to Weatherford.
But again, what would have been a makeable field goal for John Duraney instead is a punt for him.
As I said, NC State, over the years with Chuck Amato, they've been right here.
Mm-hmm.
Now they have to
finish.
Make it happen. Finish. Go back to the t-shirt. Finish. If you're Florida State, this is what you needed. Get the football back.
Pressure up the middle as Duraney knocks it high to take something off that punt. Kicking it with the win and does a brilliant job out at the three. Now actually spotted closer to the five. Good job by the punter taking something off of it with the win at his back. And 95 yards away are the Seminoles down by four. Some 95 yards away, down by four. Weatherford double clutches, hit from behind, fumble. The ball is loose, picked up by a Seminole, and a positive play as they dodge disaster there. Wow. That was Dakota Fagg who scooped up the ball after Marchell Brown had knocked it loose from behind. The entire game hanging in the balance, and he didn't fall the ball, Kirk. He scooped it up and ran with it.
Took a chance by scooping it up. It is definitely a fumble. His arm's not coming forward, so the ball is live.
How He's about in traffic there. Lowry was right with him.
Boy, gutsy. Because it worked out, it's gutsy. If he didn't pick it up, it's foolish.
Fagg gaining 9 yards on that play. Weatherford, reverse handoff inside, trying to pick his way is Smith. He's got a first down across the 20. DeJuan Morgan on the stop.
You almost have to approach this as an NC State defense because Florida State has zero timeouts. Approach this like this is the final possession. They have to score here. And the reason I say that is continue to be aggressive. Can't sit back, play a prevent defense. You've been aggressive as a defense. That's what's gotten you to this point. You have to continue to attack. And Tank Tyler, their go-to man up front, is on the sideline.
That lack of a timeout creates real urgency in this possession. Over the middle, complete. Diving forward for a short gain is Smith. The only decent drive they've had, Kirk, in the second half came when they were pinned back at the one. The other drives have all been three and out for Florida State.
That was their most consistent drive, and that's when they were their most aggressive with Jeff Bowden calling plays. If I'm on defense right now, I'm thinking about covering Brandon Warren, the tight end, number one, and whoever's lined up at tailback, either Booker or Smith. Those have been the go-to players for Weatherford.
They look near side, and it's caught. Instead, spreading the ball around, and Cody Fagg wrestled down hard at the 40-yard line. Jeremy Gray, and once again, the trend continues, Kirk. Close games between these two teams. This makes really six in a row, besides that first meeting when Amato came here and got a beating.
Well, they're always close. I mean, we've done a few of these on Thursday night, and it always seems that it's a competitive game. You could say, well, Chuck Amato knows what Bobby Bowden is thinking because of being with him for 18 years. I think it's because the programs are so similar, the athletic ability, and NC State loves the chance to play against the Noles.
And if Amato can hold this lead, he'll take a lead 4-3 over Bobby Bowden head-to-head. But his defense will have to step up here because the Noles are near midfield. That run by Smith.
Again, this is one of those things where you have to balance this drive out with the play calling. It's not just about throwing. Even though there's 4 minutes, you don't have any timeouts. They still can get into that shotgun and still run the football.
Wins against the Noles in the conference doesn't count. Miami, of course, which has only been in the league a couple of years. As you see, Nicholson, the linebacker for Florida State, his season over. Weatherford still has it. Fires near side. It's caught. Davis pushed out of bounds after a short gain into NC State territory by Scott.
This drive has that same feeling that we had when we watched Florida State go 99 and a half yards. And it's right now Drew Weatherford in command. How do you get a quarterback out of command? You get into his face with some pressure. You can't let him sit back there, look at the whole defense, survey, and then set his feet and make a throw. You've got to be able to disrupt his timing.
Seventh play of this drive, which began on their 5-yard line. Weatherford steps up, flips it short. Again, caught, and then clobbered by A.J. Davis. Short game by Smith. They're using the backs now. They do get a first down.
But every time it seems like it's 8 yards, 10 yards. Big chunks at a time, and they've quickly moved the ball across midfield down to the 36-yard line now. Good time for the tight end to try to get involved in the offense, Brandon Warren.
He's left, instead stays in, and there's a blocker, and stopping Smith for a loss is Cash. Alan Michael Cash is a backup defensive lineman. A huge play. The ESPNU All-State standings. You can see the importance of this game in the ACC. Noles, after winning at Miami, losing at home to Clemson, at 1-1. And NC State trying to go to 2-0. Second and 13. Only a three-man rush. Weatherford has time. Over the middle, deflected in. Intercepted. DeJuan Morgan has the football.
Weatherford threw into traffic and paid the price. Morgan on the carom.
Morgan has had a great game, with the exception when he let the tight end Warren slip behind him. But the safety that time, it looked like Miguel Scott got a hand in there with the initial throw to create the deflection. Just sitting there. Actually, it's Heath, the number 19, gets in there, comes up. They're thinking the same thing. It's about time the tight end Brandon Warren get the football. That time, I think Heath baited Weatherford into thinking that the tight end was open and then closed on the ball to get the deflection, and a very nice interception that time by Morgan.
First turnover of the game, and now the Noles again with no timeouts. And the flight comes out. Now it's one of those dreaded illegal substitution penalties. Can't break the huddle with more than 11 guys. Again, this guy's a backup, not a starter, but what a night he's had.
He's from Florida. He's a backup, but in this system with Steve Dunlap, he is used almost as a starter because they're in so much nickel and so much dime with five and even six defensive backs. If they can hold on here, they've got to run this clock out. This win for this program, Chuck Amato's had some big wins when Phillip Rivers was here, but the timing of this win after what this team went through early in the year, I don't know if he's had a bigger win in his career as a head coach.
And Evans just taking a knee as they'll try to bleed down the final 142. Let's check in with Reese Davis in the studio. Take on,
put him in my top five.
Take on the Hurricanes later on this season. That'll be another huge ACC collision. Jackets beat him in Miami, and now NC State again just taking a knee as we head inside of a minute to go. See when they reset the play clock here. The next snap will be third down. They have not yet reset the play clock. Now they do. They won't have to snap it again until inside of 30 seconds.
Lay down on the ground long enough, and this is the last snap of the game. Take
what
your time.
A night for Daniel Evans and this guy.
What a night for Chuck Amato and the Wolfpack. Huge win for North Carolina State. And another example of why you never assume anything in college football.
Daniel Evans, his second career start. Three touchdown passes. Doesn't make a critical mistake. Makes clutch throws, and look at the scene here in Raleigh. Second straight week, second straight come from behind conference win as an underdog for the Wolfpack.
Chris, I said it earlier. I just feel like we've seen this North Carolina State program. There's a hug there from Bobby Bowden, winning his coach, and Chuck Amato, coach who was with him for 18 years. This is as big as it gets. Let's see if he can control his emotions. Let's see if Chuck Amato has any voice left with the Docs.
Jerry?
Well, Coach, we saw a big hug with you and Bobby Bowden. What does it mean to you to be able to beat your mentor on a night like tonight?
Everything. Everything. It's for these people here. These people that help put this stadium together and make it look like it looks right now.
What about your young quarterback? What can you say about a performance of Daniel Evans, his second start ever?
Ice. A lot of ice in his veins. Kid played a heck of a game. And we didn't allow them big plays. And that's why they're such an explosive team. But you know what? Tonight, we got on track a little bit ourselves.
Could this performance by you and your team tonight maybe quiet some of those critics out there that keep writing and hammering you?
What critics? I have no idea what you're talking about.
There you go. Chuck Amato's going to celebrate, guys.
They've been vocal here before, but it hasn't always been cheers. NC State.
rallies from 10 down, wins it.
Good stuff.
24-20, goes to 2-0 in the ACC, and the Noles in deep trouble in this conference. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. For Kirk Herbstreit, Jerry Punch, and our entire team here in Raleigh, I'm Chris Fowler. Sports Center coming up right now. Wolfpack are winners tonight.